Welcome back to A Corporate Time. So, on the line with us, I got a lot to talk about. Dirt track racing and
mountain
motorcycle.
Climbing.
Yeah. Josh Owens from the show Moonshiners is on the line. How you doing, Josh?
Hey, how you doing today?
Good,
man. Thanks for the time. We appreciate it.
So, Josh,
thanks for having me.
Yeah, no problem. First, tell us how you even got on the show Moonshiners, because I'm sure it's an interesting story based on your background, because I read a little bit about you, and you've lived a crazy life.
I have lived a crazy life, man, but, I got on the show because of my late friend Barney Barnwell was a local moonshine legend, and he landed the TV show and he called me up in the middle of the night and he says, "Boy, what are you doing?" I said, "I'm in bed. I got a tree job due tomorrow." He said, "Well, you need to get your butt over here." I went over to his house. He's laying in the bed with a notepad. I thought I was going on a bootlegging run or going to Walmart to get some sugar or something or other, you know? He's laying in the bed with a notepad. I said, "What are you doing?" He said, "I'm writing my movie, boy. I got Hollywood coming." I said, "You do?" I said, "What's it called?" He said, "Moonshiners." I said, "Well, that's about perfect." I said, "You need to let me build that underground steel site so we got a place to make a good TV show." He said, "Boy, you don't want to build that thing." I said, "You supply all the materials and I'll supply all the tools and the manpower." And he said, Boy, I'm dying and going to hell and you're going from Barney's Woods to Hollywood's.
So, Josh, I'm curious to how you grew up, because with the character that you are and with everything I've saw on your social media, let's talk about your childhood. Did you have a rough one? Was it just, hey, I was open and able to do whatever I wanted?
Yeah.
Tell us about your childhood.
I've kind of had an up and down childhood. My mom went off into the Army, and I lived with my grandparents most of my life, and they gave me a great life. They were really, really awesome. But as far as school and all that stuff went, I had a really hard time in school, you know, because I was more interested in motorcycles and hunting and fishing than I was at schoolwork, you know. I just could not sit still long enough to do it. And I had my mind in elsewhere. Long story short, it just didn't go too good for me in school, and it led into a harder life for me. And I kind of ended up going to a place called Eckerd Family Youth Alternatives. I got sent off. My mom had married a guy, and he was kind of mean to me and stuff. I don't know. It was kind of rough, you know, growing up. But at the same time, there's a lot of folks out there got it a whole lot worse than I had it. But it was what it was, man.
So, Josh, I'm curious because on your Facebook, it goes through some lists of accomplishments, and they're
very unique.
Yeah, there's one of them is going 142 miles an hour, doing
142
mile an hour wheelie.
There you go, Josh.
Josh knows.
You're better at speaking than I am. And then it goes through 2002 or 2003 and 2004 Motox racing champ.
Knows his way around the motorcycle.
And then hunting, and it goes through his list, and then it says kayaked 18 miles into the ocean. And then I'm like, at first, I'm like, that's far, but then I'm like, is that far? Is that a weird thing to listen?
I think
on
a whim, it's weird, right? Decide to go 18 miles into the ocean just on a, you know, I'll give it a shot. I think that's odd.
So what is that about, Josh?
Man, me and some friends, one of my buddies, we planned a trip out to this island on this ocean, and we had to paddle out on the ocean to get there, and we camped out on the island for a week, and that was really awesome. We planned the trip, and we planned it at the wrong time too, because when we planned it, we thought we were planning to go with the tide, but we got it the exact opposite of that, and we had to paddle against the tide on the way out and on the way back. And paddling against the tide in a kayak, paddling hard as you can, there might be some kind of marker somewhere, and you'll look at it, and you'll be just sitting right there. It looks like you're kind of staying even with it. You have to, oh, man, it was a lot of work. It was a lot of fun, though.
And then also, Josh, I got to talk to you about dog goggles.
Like you're having a rough day today, Tom.
We're drunk right now.
That's goggles.
Yeah, we apologize. We've been drinking all morning.
So
hey, that's all right. That's all right.
So, Josh, you ride with your dog, Cutie Pie, on your motorcycle, and it wears goggles. And I've always been curious about dog goggles and the fact that most dogs, they'll stick their head out the window, and they seemingly aren't bothered by the wind.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Like, how do they let you know that they need...
Yeah. Does your dog, Cutie Pie, actually like the goggles, or is it just for, like, aesthetics?
You know, she didn't really mind the goggles too bad. They kind of bothered her just a little bit, but she would wear them, and when we were riding the motorcycle, she needed something to protect her eyes, you know, so... Doggles, if you look up doggles.com or whatever, they sent me freaking a whole box full of that stuff, and they supplied me with all that stuff for free.
I love
those folks. Yeah.
That's a target.
I love those folks.
That's a target-rich environment. They're like, this guy's riding doggles, and the doggles company, they're like, send a case of doggles to Josh and Cutie Pie, because that's a good marketing team. Doggles got a better marketing team than most soda companies do.
Doggles!
That's what they're called.
That's right.
Hold on.
You didn't know that? I thought you said that. The brand name of dog goggles is Doggles, and it has been for like 20 years.
Yep, goggles, that's right.
Yeah, they're as reputable as Ray-Bans, Tom. You didn't know this?
Where the hell have you been?
Have you been? Doggles or Ray-Bans or Oakleys? Yeah. Doggles have been around for 20 years.
We need to get sponsored by Doggles.
Hell yeah.
That's the best thing ever.
Well, Josh, can you put us in touch with the Doggles Corporation?
Oh, yes, sir. I'm sure I could. Yes, sir.
Let's plug his coffee, too, because I know he's got limited time.
Yeah, our friends at Coterie Coffee in Winter Park are actually one of Josh's, signature coffee suppliers.
Well, he's got a private label, bourbon-rested craft coffee. It's called Cutie Pie's Hair of the Dog, and it's a collaboration
with... That sounds great.
Yeah, it does sound amazing. With Concept Cafe and Coterie Coffee Company, it's rested and roasted and exclusively available right here in Winter Park, Florida. So, see, small world, right? Like, you think moonshiners, we know bees. Yeah. We know killer bees from moonshiners. We know you.
That's right.
Yeah, we know a bunch of different people all coming together, and then we happen to have an exclusive peek at your private label coffee right here in our city. That's pretty cool, and people can go to Coterie and pick it up.
Yeah. Josh, it seems like you've got a motor on you. You've got a bunch of different businesses. Doggles is knocking at your door. Is that something you've always...
I would have said barking.
Yeah. Is that something you've always done, man?
What?
Like, had your toe in a million different projects and... You've got a bunch of different businesses and moonshiners and
racing.
Do you still race, or do you even have time for it now that you know you're basically in Hollywood? You're an entertainment, you're a social media
it's
influencer.
Different. It's way different.
You got hundreds of thousands of followers. Like, I mean, we know a little bit something about being an influencer and how much work that is. So, do you still even have time to race?
You know, I do and I don't. You know, I'm really just so busy and so consumed with everything I have going on that I spend a lot of my time just trying to put out all the fires that I've started, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I got a lot of irons in the fire, so I'm tending a lot. And that keeps me so busy that I haven't been racing as much as I want to. And the economy being the way it is, you know, with way things have been going, it's been making it hard for me to go racing and stuff. You know, it's hard for me to justify the time and the money to go when I need to be out working on so many other projects that I got going on. But I love racing so much. Like, I will spend every single dollar I have on race cars and stuff. I have to really stay in check with myself, or I'll spend all my money on it, be completely flat-ass broke. And in the dumps trying to figure out how I'm going to damn pull it all together. Because you know how you make a million-dollar racing? You start off with two.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. No, wait, I've got relatives in the Carolinas that are into racing, and it's such a big money sport. If you want to do it and do it right, you just have to keep pumping money into it, and it is definitely you're not going to get that money back.
And, like, what?
That's right.
What, like 1% of people make money racing on sponsors, and the rest, 99%, are dumping their money into it?
Mm-hmm, for fun.
No, like, that's what it is for, like, motocross. Like, people see.
Very similar, I think.
Yeah. People see Bubba Stewart and how rich he is, and that's 1% of the rest of everybody is dumping their families
weekend to weekend, trailer,
dumping money into it. That's basically racing, right?
I tell you what, I love racing. It's kind of funny. You know, I'm sitting here, I'm digging hard as I can. You know, and I got my hands in so many things because there's so many things I want to do, and I feel like this life is so short. You know. I'm trying to get it all in there. Everybody asks me why I'm going so fast all the time. I'm like, because I got a long way to go and a short time to get there, you know. It's, everything's happening so fast, and I'm really happy because I'm getting to be everything I ever dreamed about being. You know, when I was a little kid, I wanted to be a race car driver. I wanted to be a motorcycle racer. I wanted to be an actor. I wanted to be a rock star. Like, I wanted to do all those things, and I know you can't do it all. But I kind of am. I've been in all kind of music videos and stuff, and I'm hanging out with a lot of musicians and stuff. I'm definitely not a musician. I wish I was.
That's awesome.
I'd like to be. You know, I got my hands in racing. I got this coffee coming out. I've been on TV for over a decade. How many people can say they've been on TV for over a decade?
Not many.
You know?
Yeah, that's pretty neat.
I'm just an old country boy from Columbus, North Carolina. You know, I hunt and fish and I cut trees. I still own a tree service. I still cut trees for people around town and stuff here when I'm not, you know, traveling the country filming and doing meet and greets and stuff. But I'm traveling all over the country doing meet and greets, making all kind of friends, racing motorcycles, racing cars, just doing all kind of crazy stuff, making killer TV. And I just, when I step back and I look at like a photo album or some kind of like, you know, like on Facebook or something, they'll have those flashbacks where they'll have a bunch of pictures pop up and stuff. I look at that and I'm like,
Yeah,
the time hops. Yeah, I'm like, oh my God, I'm doing it. I'm really doing it. And it's when I look at it like that, I feel like, oh my God, I've actually made a mark on this earth. But when I'm caught up in everything, man, I can't see the forest for the trees. I'm just digging hard as I can because I'm still trying to make it just like everybody else. You know what I mean?
Josh, I'm curious with owning a tree service. Okay, we're in Florida right now, and like there are a lot of demand for like quality tree cutting and like service.
Tree services around here are important because of the number of storms and lightning and everything that we have.
So constantly, I see people like, "Hey, do you know a good tree service?" And I think to myself, like, "Man, you could build a huge." Make a ton
like
of money
big
because
tree,
dude. Cutting your trees, cutting my oak trees will cost me $1,500. Like it's expensive.
That's cheap,
you know. And that is you're right. If you wanted to cut down a tree, it would be like $7,000. Anyway,
my old house, I had one. I got rid of it. It was like $3,200.
So Josh, do you get because you got so many social media followers? Is it easy for you to promote your own company? And if it seemingly you could be. You could have a gigantic multi-million-dollar tree service just from your own social media, but it's probably hard for getting employees and insurance.
It's impossible. It's doggone dang near impossible because it's hard to not be there overseeing the job, you know, and I'm right on top of it. When I do it, I'm there cutting the trees, climbing the trees, and I have helpers. You know, ground men, whatever, working with me, and you know, I'm hands on. I'm not standing back watching and stuff. I'm doing the job. So, and let me tell you a funny story real fast.
Yeah,
I don't know how long we got.
Yeah, you got time.
I wouldn't even be here right now if it wasn't for trees. And what I mean by that is, I started the tree service when I was about 20 years old, like full blown for myself, and I've pretty much been working for myself ever since. And I went to, Ivan, I think it was, that hurricane that hit Pensacola, Florida.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I left with a pickup truck, a beat-up pickup truck, a 79 Chevrolet pickup truck.
All right.
Four-wheel drive. threw all my tree gear in the back of that truck and just drove to Florida and frickin' had all my insurance and got my business license. And I went down there and worked that hurricane, and I met my friend Chris. And then Chris and my buddy Mike are the ones that started the coffee company, and that's how the coffee company came about.
That's crazy.
Right. And then what's even crazier about all of that is it led me into where when I come back from the hurricane, I went straight over to the Moonshiners farm, and then that's where everything got started with me making the moonshine and stuff. You know, I was over there in 2004 and 5, and then 2006 is when everything really got full bore. I started helping Barney, you know, make moonshine and traveling all over the country with him. And then that led into me being the movie, the TV guy, you know, like it just that whole thing just, you know how you can do a certain thing in life and you don't realize how much meaning there is to it?
Sure.
Like, I don't know quite how to say what I'm trying to say here.
Yeah, you're doing all right. I understand what you
mean.
Yeah,
I mean, if you didn't go down there, it wouldn't have set off this path that
like
you are now.
Yeah, you went to Florida, you met the people, and those things come around, and how you treat people comes around, because maybe you met the guys in Florida that have the coffee, you know, coterie guys, and you're thinking, oh, maybe I'll collaborate with these people at some point, or, you know, or the other guys that you met, and if you treat them right, yeah, it'll come back around, and you'll get to do something with them.
I never in a million years thought of any of that. It was just some old boys doing our thing, and here we are today, man. And who I am, what I am, has put me where I am. It's wild. It really is. And
yeah, go ahead.
You go ahead.
Well, I was just going to give you a big plug, man. We're about to run out of time, but I was just going to give you some love on the Instagram. It's Moonshiner Josh. You can find him. Moonshiner Josh Owens on, I believe, like TikTok, and Moonshiner Josh Owens on Facebook as well. Just search Josh Owens. You'll find him.
And MoonshinerJoshOwens.com. And if you look down on all my social media links, there's a link there to take you to my store. I'm opening a store in Greer, South Carolina this Saturday. It's called the Barnyard on 101, and that's where it's at. It's the Barnyard on 101 in Greer. If you look up that, it'll take you right to it. You guys come check me out.
Yeah, man.
I'm gonna have Henry Kenny Law there with me. We're gonna be doing like a meet and greet there for most of the day.
Well, good luck with the opening.
Check out my coffee. I'm gonna have my coffee there.
Josh. Go ahead. No. Thank you very much for talking to us today. We appreciate it, and maybe we'll catch up with you again in the future.
Hey, I appreciate it. You guys have a good day and keep on shining.
All right, thanks, man. Josh. Be good.
Josh Owens from Moonshiners. How long has that show been on the?
He's talking about a decade, right? Okay, over a decade.
That's a long
10 years. I mean, 10 years of Moonshiners. We just got Survivor.
Damn.
Survivor's just on the air.
That's a long time that show's been running.
I hate shows like Survivor. 2011. I hate shows like Survivor. I hate shows like American Idol because they make me feel old.
Yeah. No, I know. You're like, oh my God.
They're like, American Idol's 40th year. I'm like, 40th year? I'm 45. What is happening? Am I dead? What's happening?
Yeah. No, I know.
Sorry, I was having trouble talking with him. I'm just going to start being real with everything. It's like, keep tip top.
Yeah.
You're like, tippy top topping.
How did they believe he was going to do a Zoom call?
I got a follow-up email that said he's still trying to learn it.
Yeah, but, okay. Why don't we just start with the phone?
Yeah,
we're
fine.
We're fine with the phone. Don't try.
Some stereotypes, you just look at it and you go,
don't make
start
him do
the
his
phone.
Own. Yeah.
You know, if we
Josh
were
is our phone guy.
Who are we interviewing? Oh, we're interviewing an astronaut. All right, Zoom call maybe. Maybe Zoom call the astronaut. Who are we interviewing? Moonshiner. All right, start with phone. Let's write him a letter.
We'll do landline, please.
Yes, landline. Landline, not even a digit. I don't even want the spectrum.
All right, bye-bye. Welcome back to A Corporate Time. So I got to change my social media pictures.
Why? Did corporate put a mandate down? What's happening? Wait a minute. We are corporate. You don't need to do anything. Why are you changing your social media? You're never on social media.
Something inappropriate?
You're only on TikTok. You're never on Twitter. You're never on Twitter.
I when I post Instagram photos, I click the
which
Twitter.
Which is like once every 2 months.
I know, yeah.
No, he
I
did
get
good
better.
On the trip. He just like...
I think he did one big post
on
the
trip.
Yeah,
and he's like, great trip.
Right? Very concise.
I read it like that. I read it like that too. I was like, great trip.
Because it's so hard for me to post social media because
I hate it.
It's either a nothing and it's hard for me to post because I'm like, this isn't interesting or whatever. But I know that's not the whole thing. It's like, it doesn't matter if it's interesting. It just, it's something is going on in your life.
Engagement. Yes.
Engagement. And it's like, oh, look, it's going on. But it's like, to me, I'm like, don't want to post anything super boring because I feel like who the hell cares about this?
But that's all social media is.
I know. I know.
Posting, I was about to curse, stuff that nobody cares about.
I know. But that's hard for me to do. So because it's hard for me. Anyway, so then I end up just posting.
The chat room's just shredding you. Great trip. Great friends.
Oh, man.
Very good.
Yeah. Because if I posted what I wanted to.
What did you want to say that you pulled the joke? You had a joke. I pulled the joke all the time. I will write. You know, there's
stupid.
Because
it becomes negative. And
those
then,
stupid daily things I do of me riding the bike, they've become negative. And I've decided not to do them. I'm done posing. It's just dumb.
I mean, but that's what it's supposed to be. Like, people just like, oh, Daniel's riding a bike again. Then they scroll on.
Look at him. Oh, great.
Yeah, they'll comment.
Yeah.
He's doing that.
Anyway,
he's dead.
So, regardless, even if I do only post every once in a while, there's still people following, and then I need to post. I need to change my picture to make it current.
Okay.
Because they're
it's years old.
It's more than 10 years.
Is it
now.
The
that's,
one?
That's it's more than Moonshiners has been on TV.
Which one are we talking about?
Moonshiners wasn't even invented.
Were we talking about the one where you're at my wedding? Or are we talking about the one where you're
on
the back of the boat?
One of him sitting on the back of a boat with some big
the back
old
of the boat,
glasses
American
on.
Flag, and you're wearing like some, I think you're wearing some spy optics. You've got a big pair of spy.
Move a lot of hair.
You know what you're wearing? You're wearing a pair of black fly sunglasses you bought at PacSun.
This was uploaded May 21st of 2013.
Oh, 2013.
Yeah. So it's not 10 years, but I think.
My God, man.
Anyway, but that at least is my regular Facebook, which is full anyway. But
humble brag.
No, but
yeah,
like,
wow.
Oh, Lord.
it's got full.
You would think you would change it because you do look better now than you did then.
I beg to differ.
Thank you.
I beg to
differ. Well, he's lost weight. He's got a better haircut. He dresses nicer.
Oh, you're saying he looked better then than he does now?
No. I'm saying he looks better now, so he should update it because he looks
why don't we get
some? The alcohol did some damage. Yeah. Your face
I mean, you're lean,
your
but
nose.
You're blotchy. You
know? Yeah.
You're like skinny and red.
Turns a banany. Anyway, so then my other, like the public Facebook and my Twitter has Daniel's wedding photo picture of me in a suit.
Yeah, ill-fitting.
Because it was the best picture.
Big ballooning suit.
Rented khaki suit. I look at those pictures now. I know my wife thought
And you look like a sad boy.
Yeah, he wasn't. That was his.
You look like a 15-year-old sad boy.
He used to be a sad boy. He used to wear hats. He
looked
used
so
to
serious.
Like
a 15-year-old
sad boy.
Why aren't you smiling? It's a wedding.
Because I want to show how serious
he was
sad
like, this wedding is so sad.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Anyway, it was the best picture. It was because
the best picture.
Because the photographer.
No, not because of the photographer. Because you went and I paid to have your first real big boy haircut. I paid with my own money to get him a big boy haircut.
Yeah, but they gave me
going to Sport Clips and you're getting like, give me the.
That's right.
Give me what white guys get here, I guess, please.
Anyway, so I thought about this and I've gone to change it multiple times. And
to
what are your choices?
You have to change it to a young Homer Simpson cartoon photo.
So I'm really drawn towards yelling at a mic.
Okay.
Okay, so our choices are headphones. How about
chain link
headphones? You could do. There's a lot of them. You could do headphones on. You could do headphones on in front of mic. You could do yelling into mic like I'm giving my opinion. You could do that one. There's different variations of the mic. Are we going full mic? You want to so bad, don't you? Why don't we both do it? If I did it with you,
would it
make you feel better if I went mic with you? If we went mic together, I'll hold your hand. I will go full mic. And what I mean
it'll be like the Pabone shirt where you're both screaming into the mic.
Yeah, what I mean is that
like,
when
what
you,
are you screaming
when you work in radio or podcasting or something where you broadcast, it is traditionally mostly dudes do this, but it's a guy thing. You take a photo that is supposed to appear candid of you giving the what for to the microphone. You're like, hey, I'm giving my opinion right now, and I'm doing it in a way where you can tell that I am unencumbered at all. I'm literally free to give it. Unencumbered opinion. Boom. Right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So let me see your face. What face would you even make? Can you even do that? I don't even think you can do give it the mic the what for. Try and do it.
No, well, you have to do exaggerated and then pointing.
You could be like, I can't believe these wackos in the Capitol again. You know,
you're like, my finger is going through the mic and into your ear through your car,
giving you a wet willy.
Yes.
I'm telling you my opinions about Ukraine.
Digital wet willy, Ukraine.
Anyway, so. Of course, I'm not going to do that.
Okay, yeah, Mike's off the table.
So then I want to just put my family. I don't want to be that guy.
No. You can do that for the back photo. You can do it for your cover
photo. What about
photo.
One of the promo photos that Tony
Those are too old. We're both too fat.
They're more current than these.
They are. We're both double fat.
I kind of like that better.
I look like Humpty Dumpty.
So then when people see you in real life, they're like, wow, you look great.
No, I look like
double X blue.
Okay, do you want to know the story behind that? There is a real story. There is a real story behind that those goddamn photos that I hate so much. Tom set it up with Tony Monjet, who was Tony Rodriguez at the time.
Mm-hmm. Tony with an I.
Tony with an I.
I for photography.
And didn't tell me. So I showed up.
Oh, he does this every time.
I showed up dressed
even
like.
Even a documentary. I look like a goddamn fool in that documentary that is on Amazon.
I forget to tell you.
I showed up like in a shirt that had like a ravioli stain on it. So, like, I looked horrible. Yeah. And then he's like, I brought an extra shirt for me. Yeah, of course. I brought an extra shirt for me.
My
now,
God.
Who does that sound like? I've worked with people before. I've worked with people. Just saying, who does that sound like? And this guy, he made sure he looked good, but he didn't give a damn about how you and I looked. So now, in that photo, the only one that's okay is the one where we're both sitting on the couch, and then I have my legs up, and then I got this big, fat Humpty Dumpty Duke belly that rolls over, and I look like a human egg. And it's the only one we have to.
That's not my fault.
It isn't. He's right. It isn't. But not
fair.
Telling me, I would have worn a pirate shirt or something to cover my fat roll.
Or at least stand, right?
Yeah, I would have at least continued standing. But now
we just needed it fast, like, and that's the problem. The most thing
we ever needed.
We need to prepare.
We didn't. Why did we need photos?
Because it was for a presentation. I was trying to land a bigger client.
We've done so many presentations. You know how many? I got a folder on an old. I got so many presentations. I got this one goes to XM Radio, and this one goes to this one goes to.
Gotta get on that
Westwood
HD.
One, and this one goes to HD Channel 5.
Yeah, yeah. Most presentations have not gone well.
We've never had one presentation hit.
Oh man.
But we still try.
We still do them, though. It's like most YouTubers, right? Yeah. Most YouTubers, no one's watching any of your videos.
It was like,
if you're listening to me right now, there's a very, very, very large chance that you are uploading videos every afternoon and no one cares. Because that's what everybody's doing, right?
I think I've told the story, but I'll tell it again.
Hell, I upload our videos at the end of the day and no one cares.
I used to get so mad at Butler for making the cover sheet of our presentations.
Oh, it was beautiful. So much time. It was beautiful. He put so many.
He'd be like, quit
that's
spending
the
so much
hardest he worked was on the cover.
I was like, quit spending so much
it's
goddamn
the
time
to do with your
photoshopping the cover. And then one goddamn client says, I really like the cover.
You know what really what sealed the deal on this was the cover.
Validation.
Art. You had some.
I was so mad.
You had some.
Goddamn cover sheet.
You had some wicked stroke on that.
And then you kept calling it clip art to knock him down a peg.
Is that an RBG?
And then one guy really liked it. And then I was like, oh, God. Anyway.
Is that Adobe Illustrator?
So what photo should I use?
You got to get a new one.
All right, let me look through your Instagram.
Let's get new photos taken.
We need a plan ahead.
Are we doing a promo shot? That's flown, right? We're not doing that.
Should I take a photo of myself in the bathroom?
A selfie in the bathroom?
Yeah, but make sure there's a big deuce in the toilet. Like
oh,
that.
My God.
You know that one meme? I think it's... It's I forget the girl that's in it, but it's like a cute, like it's like a very attractive black girl, and she's taking a picture of herself, and in the background there's like a swirly deuce.
It's like I don't care what it is, so I just want to leave it, but then it's so old and stupid now that it's weird that I have it. So then...
You don't really have any photos of just yourself.
Yeah, no, I don't
go
care.
Everywhere together.
That's true.
They never have any away time.
Also, you do like
not
this psychopath smile a lot, which I don't know why you do that. It's too aggressive.
I don't know how.
It's his camera.
I'm not genuinely happy.
Oh, no.
Well, come on. Who is it like when they're, hey, I'm going to take a picture of you. How do you get genuinely happy? Just fake smile, right? I don't know how to fake smile.
Neither does Andrea. Neither does Andrea. When I tell Andrea to smile, it looks like she's diarrhea in your pants. I tell her, I go, wipe that off your face. I go, I'll tell her, I'll go like,
we're not emotional people.
You and Andrea are less emotional, and you guys can't smile. When you're less emotional, you don't get as much practice. And even though Andrea is more emotional than you, you're both still, you have some things that line up because I'll go smile and she'll go, I'm like, are you in pain right now? What is happening to you?
Yeah, because it's a weird thing. It's like, all right, my teeth are, you know, it's like, and then it's like, you want me to?
We should call Andrea. Do you still have her number?
Yes.
Give her a buzz and call her because this might.
That's
make
why
her
I do
mad.
The thumbs up
the
because
dice
I'm
on
awkward.
Her mad.
I'm awkward. I don't know what to do with my hands, and so I thumbs up, and because it's the like it's just a go to, and then
why don't you practice a smile? That's what I kind of told Andrea. Is like, why don't you practice it?
I have to pretend to laugh to really because my wife yells at me too about
you
it.
You have to pretend to laugh.
Well, because Crystal, she's like, she says the same thing. She's like, you look like a
serial
killer.
Pain. Yeah,
you look
you
crazy.
And Andrea both like,
She's like, why are you smiling like that? Just don't smile at all. And then she's like, no. So I had to learn how to smile in pictures, and then I pretend to laugh, and this is how I do it.
And it works.
Yeah. I go.
She may be in a meeting. She might be really... Oh, that's pretty good. That was good. That was pretty good.
Yeah. That's it.
That one wasn't bad.
It took me 30 years.
Oh, God. What line is she on?
One.
All right. It's
going to... Nope. Not that one.
Hey, babe.
Hi.
Hey, I'm really clowning on your heart because I was telling Tom, because I like to find...
I'm with you, Andrew.
I like to find the things that you and Tom have that are similar, and one of the things I found today is that you both... If I tell you to smile, you can't do it. But if you look like when I say, Andrea, we're taking a picture, I'll go, smile. If I make her smile, she looks like she's diarrhea in her pants.
Yeah, I do look like I smell the fart.
Yeah, it's like straight up fart face.
Because, Andrea, you'll agree with me, it's weird and awkward to just smile for no reason, only for a picture. Like
the And she's normally smiling. That's the weird thing about Andrea, is that she's normally smiling, but if I go smile, she'll...
Because it's fake at that point. It's hard to fake
it's
smile.
Fake. Why don't you just, instead of saying smile, just like say something or do something to make me laugh?
What are you, a baby? Hold on, I'm a dad.
That sounds like something Tom would say. Hold on a second. That is so Tom.
I'm switching sides to Dan now.
Wow. She just said something. I got chills
and
right now.
And we bonded over Little House on the Prairie.
We're having some severe trauma bonding today. That sounds like something you would
you
say.
You got to be like, hey, look at me.
Yeah, it's like victim player.
Funny faces.
It is very baby.
It is very baby. Yeah, you need to shake a rattle in front of us. Like, because hold up a lollipop.
This is insanity.
Because it's hard. Well, yeah, because it's like, hey, look like you're super happy right now on the spot. We're like, well
watch
am
me.
I super happy about taking this
Think
picture
about
right
it
now?
When you turn on for the show, right? Yeah. Just turn on your face as if you're
It's easy.
Happy.
Watch. I'm going to smile. Ready? I'll look right at the camera and smile. See? It's a real smile. You have a great smile. It's not like you're an ugly
it's
person.
Awkward.
I married you. I think you're hot as hell. But
it's
when...
Awkward.
Yeah, the more... I'm Andrea, me and you are realer humans. and this is where this way. Because we're legitimate. Everything... Our facial expression has to be real. It cannot be fake. So we're the real humans.
The two reals.
Or you're robots that don't have emotions.
One or the other. One or the other. Either we're really real or not real at all.
Oh. Well, I love
you. Maybe I just don't want to take the picture. How about that?
There's the real.
I don't want to take anything. Like, just take a picture. Do it candid and just take
Those
a picture.
Those are the worst.
No, no.
Candids are bad. Then you got your...
No, why don't, instead of somebody telling us to smile, TC, we will just do resting B face.
You can say bitch.
Oh, I didn't know I could say it.
Yeah, you can say it.
You can say it on all platforms.
Yeah, on all platforms.
Oh, I didn't know that.
I let my son say it.
Oh, yeah, my God. Tommy came here this morning. He's like, what's up, bitch? And I'm like, what's up, Tommy? It's the boss's son. I can't say
anything. He also screams these nuts now.
He did.
I literally don't know how to handle it. Like, I don't know whether to tell him not to.
Say the same thing when you thought he was saying Homer.
No,
when he actually said Homer.
Well, yeah. No, the D's nuts.
I didn't share that with anyone.
I just laugh.
Yeah. He's going to start screaming it at school, though, and you're going to get in trouble.
It's Castleberry. Apparently, everybody.
Does he chop his crotch?
No.
He says it?
Oh, well, no. He might. The video I saw, he just goes, D's nuts.
Like that?
He was cool.
He says like Snoop Dogg.
He says like Snoop. He's cool. D's nuts.
All right, Andrea.
Get out of here. I love you.
Smile.
Okay, smile. Love you, bye. See, I'm telling you, I'm finding these things,
This is weird.
It is weird. But I think we should line up Tony
Well, then
Mungette.
We should do a photo shoot. You don't have to smile. You can do like a serious pose. Businessman.
Businessman pose.
Yeah.
But you did a few of those last time. You have a couple of those. On your email signature, that's a decent photo.
Hands in my pockets.
Get the hands out of the pockets, dude.
Yeah, the right was just going crazy.
Yeah, because I was kept doing thumbs up, and Tony screamed, "Put your hands in your pockets," because you can't control
like a lonely politician.
He's smiling in this one.
Is he? Is it a crazy smile?
So do I just stand there and then look at the camera and smile, and then that's my picture? In where? In the studio?
We can go somewhere.
Give me a serious face.
And a garden?
You need to stand in a garden. Does anyone have a garden we can use?
Yeah, whose garden can we use?
Where do I go?
You just said it. We go to the garden.
No, but why is it a garden? Like, why is your picture you smiling in a garden?
Well, we did a few in here. With the one
that's weird. I never go to a garden.
The one that Tony uses.
Gardens don't make me happy.
Tony used one, not Tony Mungette, but Tony Palmiotti used one, and he uses it for everything. Every deliverable we have, and it's us standing in the studio, and we're fat pigs. We're just big.
Boy's bullying us.
Yeah, he is bullying us.
Well, we had
us,
the good one when we were all outside the studio, but now we got to edit Butler out of it.
We don't have to. Butler's fine. Like, he's good.
But he's not part of the company anymore.
Yeah, no. But most people don't even know.
Yeah, they don't even know.
They don't even look at the pictures.
People are just now getting caught up. I got a message yesterday. Somebody's like, Butler's gone? I'm like, all right, that's the way it works. News cycle. Come on.
Holy smokes.
Oh, yeah. And then all this, like, I think we need the cover photos or, like, pictures. Like, here's a TND media team or here.
Yeah, we need that. I'm a big fan of this is our team, and then here's our mission statement. If you don't have either of those, can't be successful in business.
Can we stand on the roof?
We'll stand with, like, our arms crossed and our backs to each other, right?
That's the TND advantage. We need a catchphrase.
That's how you get rich. I can't.
We need a consultant to come in.
I can't.
Tell us a bunch of garbage.
Yeah.
Take new photos. Get a slogan.
Dare got me $1 million. Like if
that's right, we did get you $1 million.
If we
Greeny and Mr. Snurts should be a part of the promo photos, I believe.
Like,
what if we took a picture?
If I was this type of person, we could be rich.
What if you just dress up the puppets as yourselves and use that as your promo photos?
And it's just our no heads. It's just our bodies holding.
No, it's just the puppet dressed as you, like a Build-A-Bear, but it's a Build-A-Puppet.
Okay.
So we've got short little dukes and a polo on Mr. Greeny.
I'm not at all anti that.
Let's do it.
Well, the promo. But what should I do for my own social media?
Like, same thing. If you don't care.
But that's the thing. Do I put the show as my photo?
Well, what are you going to use it for?
For show promotion.
What are you going to use it for?
What else do you use your social media for?
Nothing. I mean, I post pictures, like family pictures, and then sometimes I'll make
Does your family actually comment and care about it?
No. Exactly. But I'm just putting it, because that's all I know what
right
you like, post about your family or whatever.
Right now, you just have the one, it's just the muffalata picture, and then the frame of Don't Say Gay around it, right?
What are most people's standard?
Like mine is
business photo. You mean?
I think
like
I changed
social
mine
media.
Recently. Mine is
or do they change? I mean, how often are you supposed to change it?
I change mine about once or twice a year, and
once
the last
twice
one
a year.
I changed it was the picture when I went with the to the Villain Surf locals only surf competition with you and the Wizard and your families. So and I took a picture on the beach, and it was black and white, and I was like, oh, that's cool, that's different. You know, I'll put that one up there.
So that's the norm, is like a couple changes a year or a quarter or whatever, and then and
once
just
every 6 months
of something that you've normally current that you post, and that's it, right?
So unless like something happens traumatic to you, like I feel like if you lose a lot of weight, you should take a new one. If you lose a limb, like if you're in an accident and your leg gets chopped off, I feel like you should take a new one to reflect that you lost a leg or an arm, right? You're laughing at that, but I mean, like, it's just, you know, it's just courtesy.
Do you do the picture in the picture, like you said, where you have your main picture but then a tinier picture on the top right? Because I, you know what I'm talking about?
Like, oh, okay. Well, top left, you mean?
Or, yeah, left. Yeah.
Well, the main picture, you're confusing, Pop-Pop, you're confusing your cover photo with your actual avatar.
Yeah, I was like, what is he talking about? Okay.
The avatar is you, and the cover photo can be something that reflects a style cue that maybe you like a boat or a tropical
scene.
That
could be your family, yeah, right? The cover photo.
Your family is the cover photo, and then you're the main photo.
But that, like, cheesy, right? People are like, ah,
I think most dads
cheesy.
Do that. What's cheesy is when it's like Melissa and Thomas's Facebook, and they share one.
No,
that's cheesy.
My buddy is not allowed to have his own.
Yeah, yeah.
He's not allowed?
Yeah, because he cheated on his wife if he did. That's the only thing keeping him from cheating on his wife is not having his own Facebook. Yeah, that's why I always laugh at those, because it's like, really? Just that's the thing stopping it?
That's the barrier?
Yeah, he's not on there, so you're good. You're fine. You're fine. It's not happening then. Out of sight, out of mind. Why would it happen in any other way? If you have that, right? We see that and we're like, a little bit, right?
Yeah.
You're like, a little bit of jail.
Yeah. And then he's like, I don't care. What do I care? I'm not on it anyway.
Right. Yeah, but that's how they justify it. Yeah. Is it Pudge? Tell me.
No. He's a real man.
Only fishing on Facebook. Only fishing on Facebook.
Yeah, yeah. The fish you caught, that's it.
Yeah, that's it. And he always catches the one with the golden halo on it. He, like, posts that.
Yeah, yeah. Maybe one gas person. Yeah.
All right, who's somebody you respect? And let's look at their Facebook photos, and let's, you know, let's try and mimic that.
All right, Travis Pastrana.
Tracy Butler.
His are probably pretty good. Butler takes a damn good look. He's
gorgeous.
He's a good-looking guy.
Big, Busey teeth. Perfect.
God, he really should be Uncle Baby Billy.
Walton Goggins, he could pull it off.
All right, so you have him in his full racing gear and smiling, genuine smile.
What's a background? What's a cover photo?
And his cover photo is, I'm assuming it's him in the car jumping over a boat.
Oh, that's
don't
cool.
go gravedigger. No, too old.
That's too old. It's got to be current. Jump over Oasis.
Would you jump the Oasis? Answer now.
Hey, Cactus Steve was out there this weekend.
Cactus Steve goes to anywhere that there are T words for boobs.
Boobas.
Yeah, sorry. About to say it. We're running a little loose today. We're getting a little loose today.
I've been trying to contact Oasis, too, because I'm like,
the best way to contact him is by flying over them.
Did you reach out to the contact info I gave you?
Yeah, never. But they gave me some other numbers and beeper.
Beeper number?
Hey, you got to beep Harvey.
Well, you're by there all the time. Just go in there.
Everybody calls him Harv. You got to beep Harv.
I don't like cold calls because, like, you go in there and then everybody...
You got to make friends with the staff.
You show up, you're wearing a suit.
The one from your wedding.
Do you still have that?
Oh, yeah. I got all my suits.
You know why he still has it? Because the place we rented it from, the guy...
I can never throw away a suit.
That owned it. Okay, this is a crazy story. I still have mine too, but the guy that owned the particular place that we would rent suits from and tuxedos and did dry cleaning,
he passed away.
So we still have all the stuff we rented from him because he died. Like, I have a full tuxedo in my closet that I have a dead man's tuxedo in my closet.
It's the, I wonder if.
Should I get rid of that? That's like bad mojo in my family or something, right? That's like a lesser monkey paw, I feel like.
All right, we'll be right back.
Welcome back to A Corporate Time. I figured we'd jump into some voicemail messages.
All right.
Over the vacation, we had quite the backup. My God, I'm looking at a lot of new ones. So we'll just kind of take it from the top here.
Hey, guys. This is Josh in Avalon Park. I had a question. I want to get your guys' opinion. What are your thoughts on valet parking?
I mean, anyone here? I mean, I'm a fan. Without knowing what he's going to say,
I like it as an option.
If I have the coin, I will always beg Andrea to do it. Now, I'm not saying she's going to do it.
Now,
but I will beg her to do it.
Free valet parking.
Always.
Always.
Oh, of because, course.
I mean, always. $10 for a tip is fine. And then someone to park your car and then come get it.
Yeah.
For $10, great. When it comes to like certain the hotel valet parking and stuff like that, where it's like $50
right.
or whatever, then you got a tip. Yeah, you're kind of like, well, I'd rather just park for $60. You know, can I just park? And then like parking's not an option. And you're like, well, this is, I feel like you're robbing me. You're forcing me to pay $60.
It's a lot.
I guess I get the convenience of it. I'm not a fan. I don't know if it's the fact that I don't carry cash, like tip the people, even though a lot of these places will say complimentary. But you know, I was recently at a we took a trip to Sarasota and we went to this botanical garden and there was some construction around, and I guess the only option at the time when they had a temporary parking lot, once that fills up, is they have to valet your cars. And like it's like me and my wife, we're sunburned from being at the beach. Like I got to get the kids out of the car. They got their dirty, stinky car seats in there. I got this young dude who's like, oh, give me my ticket to like valet my stink car with my nasty car seats in it. Like, I don't know. I know that's not your typical valet situation, but it kind of got me thinking like what's your opinion on valet parking in general?
I'm feeling
so he's embarrassed about his own.
Yeah.
Well,
that's
on you, sir.
Yeah. Well, this is a problem.
This is a Tom thing.
Yes. And Daniel will not understand this.
Look,
but
people are going to know who you are.
There's been plenty. Not even. I don't even care if they know who you are. Just general shame and how you live your life.
Right. General shame.
Because I've plenty of times have gone to a valet and started stuffing fast food bags under my passenger seat or hiding my shame all around the car so the valet doesn't get into
my cars. Never get this
they
dirty.
Know. They know.
Yeah, I know.
I never let my vehicle get that dirty.
I have like old smoothie cups and fast food. I'm stuffing it, hiding it.
I have never driven a car I have driven a car from the day I started driving a car until right now. I have always kept my car in a condition where any person, the Queen of England, anyone could drive in it. It's not gross. It might be full, a little trash here and there, maybe a soda can on the floorboard
here and there.
It's always
nice.
That's as far as it gets, is a soda can on the floor. And it's got to be a relatively dry one. And there has to be a monster.
I would never even do that.
There has to be a monster mat in there, because if it's a monster mat, I'm going to hose it out when I wash it anyway. I don't care.
Yeah, yeah. Daniel, if you're a valet, you get in Daniel's car, you're like, oh, this is nice.
Yeah, it smells good in my car. Like, you get in, you go, it smells pretty good.
Might have a crumpled napkin in the side door. That's about it.
I have napkins in my car, but they're in the glove box for when things spill.
Right. But I'm saying if you have to use one, there might be one crumpled in the corner. But then as soon as I get out of my car, I take it with me and throw it in the trash.
She knows.
Here's another trashy shame in a valet is trying to disengage my ignition key from the rest of my janitor keys that are obviously to nothing valuable while the valet looks at me do it. And then I'm sitting there trying to get my fingernails.
You have keys to locks that aren't even being used on a
key. As if I'm trying to protect this man, like my jewels from the valet.
He looked at your car. He knows there's no jewels.
I know, but I still feel obligated.
He probably thinks you are a janitor.
I know. That is like, but I still feel obligated to take all the rest of my keys off for no reason.
As opposed to just giving him the whole thing.
Yeah. Because usually it's Crystal yelling at me, take the rest of the key, the house keys, all the boat keys. And it's like, this guy, it doesn't matter. Like, no one's stealing. No one's finding our address and making a copy of our key to come later to bring it. It's like, it doesn't matter. But I'm fidgeting with it while my wife hides the garbage. And then it stinks.
I'm a big fan of the valet. I dig it.
Oh, another shame.
Oh, wow.
Realizing that your gas light is on
while you pull into the valet,
and the valet
is gonna
get in and then think to himself, is this car gonna run out of gas on the hotel
I've
property?
Seen that is real, and they were clowning hard. I saw that Universal one time, and these young boys were clowning these people hard.
And here's the move. You have to say, oh, man, I was just about to pull in and get gas. It just turned on. You lie to them so that they don't worry about.
Wow, you're a bad person. Dude,
the number of little lies that he has to tell the cover.
It's a hide my trashiness.
Yeah, so much shame.
I lie to hide my trashiness. Yeah.
So many shame.
Oh, another one.
Huh?
So you only have like $3 to $4 and you should be tipping.
Oh, this is
more.
The worst one. This is the worst one where you pay for valet, but only got enough money to pay for valet. You have no more money
yeah,
now.
Yeah. So you look through you and your wife's purse or wallet
for change,
and then you have you have $3. No, you don't do change.
You have Fazoli's gift card.
Now what? Here's what you do with the $3. You roll it tight, right?
No, not the roll tight.
And then you do the move where you're pretending to be the rich guy that handshakes him the money.
Buy yourself something pretty.
And then when you do that and you handshake someone the money, they instinctively close their fist and then say thank you and walk away without looking at it.
Right.
Because, like, instead of presenting it to them, they see the $3 and realize you're a poor POS.
Yeah, yeah.
And so you have to handshake them the $3 so that they don't realize that you stiffed them until they get, like, by that time
or
they're in
the
car driver.
Or if they have the box, you can get lucky, and sometimes they have the tip box.
Oh, yeah.
Some hotels have it. They're getting rid of it, though. But you go over, and you got to, like, so what I do is I reach into my pocket and pull out a receipt. And then if you can go fast enough, if you can get that receipt into the box without them seeing the white of the paper, you can tap it and the paper will go in there and it's like you're giving money, but you're not.
Here, like, okay.
Learning a lot today.
And
I do that at the car wash sometimes.
So this is the problem I have with tipping at fancy hotels. Where I don't know the person. Okay, they won't let you take your bags up.
This is the problem I have with keeping in fancy hotels.
Well, so the valet that come and gets your bags, right?
Yeah.
Like, do I tip him or the person? Because they're a different
You're
person.
You're supposed to do both.
Yeah, it's supposed to be both. That you tip the car guy and the guy that takes your
the
bags.
Bellhop.
That's two separate guys.
Yes.
One is a valet, and she's right. One's a bellhop.
So
you can't lump those two together. The fact that you don't know that, oh, the ignorance here.
But I always tip the valet when they, at the end, when they deliver the car.
Correct.
So, but do I tip the guy that I put the luggage on the valet cart, and then that guy takes it to the desk, and then they bring it up to the hotel? Do I tip him just for taking it to from my car to the desk?
Well, normally he comes up with you, no?
No, it's a different person, because then they're like, we'll deliver your bags
okay,
like,
I
later.
See what you're saying. I think you are supposed to tip anybody that touches it. You're supposed to tip them.
There's another trashy hotel problem, is that we always get to the hotel.
Maybe you should stop staying at nice hotels if you can't afford to tip the
people
that are
working.
I
want
to be feels like you're paying a lot of money to just be out of sorts at all times. You're like, I pay all this money, and I don't know how to use anything.
I just park myself and bring my own bags up.
Well, I'm trying to live beyond my means, like every American.
That's what I do.
And when I go to the Omni or whatever, I want to use the water park before my hotel's ready, so I show up at noon, but the hotel's not ready to 4,
right.
So they bring your bags and they hold them.
Oh, you bring them into the pool area. They love that. Drag them all in. All your bags, everything, and they put it under the umbrella.
And then you use the water park for an extra day, that way you don't waste
that. They love that.
You go and use it early, and then your room is ready at 4, but then someone else brings your bags up, so I'm like, well, I just tipped the guy for bringing my bags. Do I have to tip the guy for bringing my bags? Oh, God.
Yeah.
Anyway,
that was your fault for going to the water park early. That is a trash move.
We ain't checking in yet. We're just using the facilities.
And then you, when you check out, because you got to check out at 11.
Do you guys lay there at the water park all night to get your money's worth? You trash, trashos.
You ask them to hold your bags, and then you use the water park.
Oh, they love that.
Yeah.
You use the water park.
Yeah, because they want to watch your stuff.
They got a room. They just put it in a room. 2 days of water park.
I will never vacation with Tom Vann.
That's what people do.
That's pretty bad.
That's what people do.
You're not supposed to be doing that.
No, they allow it. They say you can come early.
Yeah, they allow a lot. They'll allow you to poop your pants in the room. They will allow that. That is allowed.
They will arrest you for it.
I think it's encouraged. You're not gonna get it's encouraged.
I don't know that. It's encouraged.
And the room that they're putting your bags in is a conference room that they did need, but they've got so many trash people's bags in it, they can't use it anymore. Some of those trash people leave their bags. They forget. They the whimsy of the water park, they lose their mind and they leave their bags. They just go home. No bags. Okay.
There's nothing important in there.
No, there's not. Like seven pairs of jean shorts.
Yeah.
Let's try this one. I think you guys are going to like this one. This one is for Sam.
Oh, no.
Pay attention.
Hey, guys. You've been talking about this mystery leak in the studio for quite some time now, and I've been a plumber for 12 years, and if it was a real leak, I'm pretty sure you would have seen it by now. It would find the path of least resistance and come through the drywall. My speculation is it's someone's coming home, taking a hot shower, and it's possibly the hot water line expanding and contracting inside the wall, which can make a clicking and ticking sound. Just letting you know that's a possibility, because if it's water, I'm pretty sure you'd see moisture by now. Just a thought. Tell me I'm wrong.
I trust you.
It's possible.
Now, what he said actually does make sense because you will hear water being turned on. That I have heard. I think we can all confirm that. The clicking would make sense of they're taking a hot shower. The water line's cooling and expanding. Right?
Like that's what it sounds like.
I can.
We'll say though that there was water damage before on the other wall. When the whole carpet was soaked with water, remember that?
Oh, that was a thing.
Now, this is a different. This is the wall closest to me now that we're hearing this, so we're just a little nervous that you know there's more.
I keep thinking it's just gonna happen. I think it's gonna be a wave that pushes you out of the door.
I do too. Yeah,
like one of those like huge.
I 100% think. I thought I was gonna when you guys were gone out of town and I was coming in to fill the fish tank. I thought for sure I was gonna come in here and it was all just gonna be flooded.
I love seeing what happens when you ignore things for so long. Yeah. Like, what is the result of this?
It's like leaving the ash on your cigarette. How long can we make it?
Man, my mom used to let, like, almost the entire cigarette was an ash.
Yeah, if you can get the whole thing ash and it's a 100, thank you for your service. My God.
Like, how long can I go without changing my transmission fluid or oil or servicing my AC? If the theme is trashy people, that's I've done that my whole life.
Indeed. Like, let's try. Oh, sorry.
And I'll just, can it go 15 years? Like, and then at some point, it's like, this is an amazing feat.
Anyway. I think you can.
You know,
I've kind
my
of
my truck.
I'm doing it in. I remember I gave Andrea the newer car that we have, and I took her older car. It's the one. It's my daily driver now because I don't drive a lot.
Yeah.
And I am now doing what you told me to do. I have left it. I did not change it for daylight savings time. And it's driving me insane, and made me late a couple times, or like confused. And but I, you know, I'm gonna try it. I'm gonna give it a shot.
Because then, after a certain amount of time, you're like, oh, it's coming up.
Yeah,
it's coming up to be right.
I see it. It's not. I don't necessarily agree with it, but I am gonna try. It's like my daughter, and the reason I'm trying is like I tell my daughter all the time. I'm like, you don't have to love it. Just try it. It's what I'm doing with your thing. I'm gonna try this. This whole like not changing my clocks thing, and see where we get with it.
Hey guys. I'm a lifelong resident of New Smyrna Beach, and I'm glad you brought up the golf carts and teenagers. This week's spring break, and it has been madness. The business owners of Flagler, not too happy, and I've never been a fan of these golf carts on the roads since they came about a few years ago. But now there's just loads of teenagers driving around, cursing at people, running stop signs. It's madness. So yeah, I hope this is the beginning of the end. And two, I hope you play this on ACT, because this to all the parents that sent their kids over here to New Smyrna, it's your fault that you sent all your little D-heads over here unsupervised, sending them to all these Airbnbs and just letting them run wild. Parents of the year.
Mad. He's mad.
So is he saying that parents will rent out an Airbnb just for teens?
Yeah.
And then, well, dude, report that to Airbnb. That's not allowed.
Apparently that's a thing.
Well, I guess you could say, no, I was there. You could lie to them or whatever, right? You know, they're not going to send out the Airbnb inspector.
Police, yeah. Like, I'm an Airbnb. Is there an Airbnb inspector?
Like, maybe.
All they will do is, like, check in on it, and then you're like, no, I was there. And they're like, oh. Like, I don't, they're not going to do much else.
I would report it, sir. Tom doesn't know nothing.
Well, I guess if the like, enough reportings, and then the person who's renting it gets into trouble, right? Then you're compromised as a rentor or super renter or whatever those things are, right?
Super host.
Super host.
If your rating gets affected, right. Also, you know, but I mean, it's also because like all the beach communities have become so expensive that it's majority rich people now, unless you've lived there for 30 years or whatever, right. Like old family. Like if you recently moved near the coast or near the beach, you're living in a more than a $500,000 house.
Oh, at least.
And then so as that gets more and more, and it will, as property values continue to rise, then it's going to be, if you live near the beach, you're a millionaire, right? Or you have $1 million house.
Right.
And so that if you have $1 million house, then you got a bunch of golf carts and toys and so, you know, and then you get a bunch of rich, spoiled kids that drive them around. It's only getting worse.
We got them around here, you know. Yeah.
The more money, and then it's like, the more money you have, there's like...
No problems.
The stereotype is that you let your kids do whatever because you're either too busy or don't care or you're entitled and you're like, you just throw money at it, you know. Like, and that will continue to be a problem in sought-after neighborhoods. Yeah. More and more golf carts are going to happen. It's not going away.
No, it's not going away.
Unless the city bans them, but I doubt they would because...
It's revenue for them, and it makes the people happy. The people are bringing them in. They have to get them registered.
There's going to have to be a lot of accidents for people to like make a change. Yeah.
Now, with your kid drive, like you can't drive on the road unless you were 16 and have a driver's license.
That's not stopping them, though.
It isn't. So I guess the cops enforcing that will then... Because
For the first time, and I forgot about this, I did see somebody had got pulled over here. It wasn't a kid, but it was a guy. I saw in Baldwin. Because those guys,
they run every single stop sign.
It wasn't a maintenance guy. It was a...
No, I'm not talking about... regular people.
It was just like a resident. And I'm like, okay, yeah, all right. I'm okay with that. I'm okay with golf carts as long as you're just...
Abide by the rules,
You're being cool, bro.
I'm sure they're cracking down because a lot of people complain, right? So then they put pressure on the cops and then they start writing more tickets.
I'm not sure of it, but I feel confident my wife complained.
Yeah.
She complains about everything. Like, but not to me. You know, like, she's the good kind of complainer. Like, I'm the bad
guy. She goes where things get done.
Yeah, I'm the complainer where I'm just like, ah, my bad.
You complain to people that can't do anything about it.
You hear about that? Yeah, I'm that kind of complainer. My wife will be like, I'm going to get this changed. You know, and then she'll, you know.
She's a Karen.
Yeah, a little bit. Let's try this one.
Hey, guys. My name is Justin. I'm from Clearwater. I've been a listener for... forever.
Oops.
I've never called in, never sent an email or anything, just kind of a silent BDM. Just listening to the BDM show about cheating. I mean, if you guys want to talk more about it, you can be more than welcome to call me. Basically, I was married for 8 years with my ex-wife for 12. And she had an affair with some dude that she was at work with. We lasted through my deployments in the military. And apparently she was hooking up with a guy while I was on duty as a firefighter now.
Oh.
Found out Valentine's Day, 2020.
So. No, not Valentine's Day.
Oh, that's the last year.
During the pandemic?
Oh, my God.
I guess that's right before, right? February.
Did she tell you that through a mask? Because I feel like that's insulting.
That's called a Jody, right? When the person...
You're using your jarhead knowledge. I watched that movie too.
Yeah, the person that your wife is cheating on you with
is a Jody.
Is Jody.
Yeah.
Does it work with other like cops and firefighters? I feel like
cops,
it's kind of Jody Light.
Jody Light.
It's a kind of the
cops
same thing.
Cops are like more like a Jody Watley. That's the only Jody I can think of. Are there any famous Jodys?
I want to find out how he knew or found out. It's usually something simple. Like,
well, he might tell us. Hold on.
The 2 years, it was tough, but I mean, for anybody that's out there, you'll get through it.
There you go.
You know, you guys were talking that it's one of those things where you can kind of see it coming and stuff like that. And I didn't, I was happy as hell the day before. So, but now I'm with the girl of my dreams and happier than ever.
Hold on. Alex is like, I've listened to the show for 8 years. I've never called, emailed, anything. But today I decided to call you and tell you something super personal.
I like that.
Sometimes
insanely personal about my life.
Sometimes people resonate with them. Just
seems
because
like Jody is like specifically for Marines.
Yeah, I think it is a Marine thing. Yeah,
and it's technically any man who stays home while everyone else goes to war. He gets to enjoy all the things the Marines are missing, more specifically the Marines' girlfriends back at home while the Marine is away on active duty.
I never really thought of it like that.
Well, like he didn't like... He said, I got the Funyuns.
Now I'm about to have the Funyuns with your girlfriends. The reason they're called Jody specifically dates back to black soldiers in World War II. They took a character from an old blues song named Joe the Grinder. Or Joe D. Grinder.
Everything always.
Name of the blues song was named Joe the Grinder or Joe D. Grinder, who would steal the ladies of inmates and soldiers and clipped his name to Jody.
Joe D. Grinder?
We need to come out with a shirt.
Joe D. Grinder.
Let's do it.
I'm Joe D. Grinder. That's awesome.
This is my wife. I'm Joe D. Grinder. This is my wife, Jody Grinder.
Different.
Totally different.
So let's do what you're
doing. I can finish what he's saying.
Oh, okay.
So.
No, we're way over.
Play it for anybody that's going through some shit.
Oh!
Shut up, Lefty.
There it is. That's how you do it. All right, bye.
That's a grind. Welcome back to a court. Oh, God.
It's happening.
What did you do?
It's the Swiss cheese.
What'd you do? The
welcome. I literally just asked him Friday one, and he was like, "Welcome back."
Welcome to.
It doesn't really matter at this point.
No.
Welcome to. Welcome back. Why don't we just figure out something
just
that works
welcome.
For both?
You know,
what works for both?
I try to be professional, thinking that that's what people want me
they
to
don't
be.
Want
they
don't
know
want
that we're not professional.
They don't want that.
Or do they want me to try and fail?
Now, on the line with us.
That's what they want.
I'm doing a great job.
Via the Zoom, we have a couple of guests that they try to be professional as well. Maybe they can help you to be more professional. It is the Shelfers, Jana and Jason. Where are you guys? You guys are at home right now, right?
Yes.
We are.
Welcome home.
We're actually at our kitchen table.
I like that. Well, you look good and you sound good. You said you've been changing things up in your studio to make things a little bit better, and it shows. Well done. Sounds good.
We're feng shuiing. We're feng shuiing our
Oh, no.
Our
don't say that.
No.
Tom doesn't believe in that.
And feng shui.
Yeah, we can talk about feng shui. Everybody feng shui tonight. Mm-hmm. That's what I say.
Because I did.
Just got under Tom.
No, well, Daniel's laughing because.
Our old boss believed in it, and she spent a lot of money on it that she could have used to pay me and him, or even you, Jana, when you worked there.
Yeah.
So that's why
it's the power of feng shui. Yeah. That's where the money should be spent.
The only reason.
And magic.
The only reason anyone in that building was ever successful is feng shui. They owe it all to feng. I could call him that because I know him really well.
Full feng freak out.
Yeah, full feng freak out.
So what is feng shui?
Out with your dung out is what I say.
Because, besides from the overall mumbo-jumbo magic of
it's fumbo-jumbo, sir. or fungo-dungo.
There is some part of the psychology of feng shui
put your coffee cup closer.
Is that how it's pronounced? Because it's spelled F-E-N-G.
Yeah, it's feng shui.
Feng shui?
You're right. It is F-E-N-G. And we have this little compass, and Jason calls it our functionator.
I like that. You're ready for your own kid show with that.
Let's go to the functionator, kids. Where are we going this week, Jason?
We're going back to ancient Greece. Like that? You know what I'm talking about,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah.
We're going to learn all about the Romans and how they had vomitoriums, and they liked the little boys.
Now, everyone needs a vomitorium.
I'm sorry, Jason.
If everything in life is energy... It makes sense that you wouldn't want to block that energy or you would want to have pathways of that energy to come into your sphere, right?
Oh, God, I feel like I'm sitting
Here's
on the white
the
couch.
Thing.
The old white couch.
I feel like
the old fun couch.
Negotiating our corporate time contract.
Yeah. We'll do it for free or nothing. So, did you guys bring in a professional to guide you in feng shui?
I'm actually taking a class with Marie Diamond.
Marie Diamond? Oh my God, Dustin Diamond's mom? Holy crap, how did you get Screech's mom to teach you feng shui?
Oh man, she's sad.
Yeah.
No, because she took part in that movie, The Secret. Do you remember that movie, The Secret?
I remember the book. The book was the one.
People heard about it because it was a secret.
It's the same thing, right? Isn't that book that everybody was like, if you read this book, then you'll be able to channel all your energy into being the best form of you.
I am all about learning. I love to learn all about the psychology. And so what I'm finding is that Jason and I actually are opposites on so many things. So like in the bedroom.
Oh, he likes
really
dudes.
Oh my gosh.
Yep, that's what Andrea found that out about me. It ruins everything when she finds out that I really lust for the guys.
It's true.
But if we
put our bed one way, it's actually the wealth position for me, but it's the poverty hole for him.
You don't want to be looking at his poverty hole. That's terrible. Oh, yeah. My God.
Never
look at it. Put a napkin over it.
Post-it note.
Post-it note on your poverty hole.
But can you actually feel the difference? Because this is where it, and maybe I'm just
immune to
it. Of
course you can't. It's not real, Tom.
Okay, wait, listen to this.
Okay.
So we just started this class. I've been binge watching this class.
Yeah.
I started it, 4 days ago?
Yeah, probably four. It was Monday. Well, what day is it? Monday.
So the first thing I noticed
through it,
that
man.
In my health corner of my, first of all, the health corner of my bedroom, I had painted this ceramic vase. Like I painted the ceramic vase, and I, at the time when I was learning how to paint, I couldn't paint eyes. So I just painted this girl's eyes of her sleeping. Go find the vase and we'll show them.
Oh yeah.
You like just painted this
creepy
girl's
ceramic
eyes of her sleeping
eyes.
Now,
you put that
in. It's weird that I literally was depressed for 2 years and I couldn't get out of bed for 2 years. And I've been so tired and lethargic. And I've been studying her and she's like, if you want to know your energy level, look at what item you have in your house in this position. And I looked over there and I'm like, oh my gosh, I have a ceramic vase and I painted that. And the girl's literally going,
okay.
It's a face.
Yeah, yeah. So you look at the face and like where your area of
sleepy face.
Yeah. Oh, that's really quite. That's
terrifying.
Really, it's not terrifying. You're a good painter, I would say. I mean, that's well done.
Also, the biggest vase.
You guys buy everything. Everything in your house is like opulent.
3 feet tall. God,
every time you come to us, it's like you're coming live from Saddam Hussein's palace. Everything is.
Wait until we get feng shui'd out. It's really going to look.
So wait till you see my vision board. Wait till you see what my vision board looks like.
So, Jana, Jason, I will say, like, a lot of people roll their eyes at this stuff, and even me.
Including
because
we do.
Yeah, we make fun of it. I'm skeptical, and I'm like, this is all nonsense. But there is real science, and I know this because we saw a professional sports team do this. Okay, so we taught internally in Orlando City. They talked about there was a sports team. I forgot who it was.
Yeah,
but
I remember
they would paint, or they painted the inside of the traveling team's locker room pink, right? Because science has shown that if you are around pink, the color pink,
it just kind of lightens you up a little
that
bit.
You become less aggressive, and therefore
sucking some of that fight out of you, right? You're sitting in the locker room getting ready, and you're just sitting in like a baby's nursery.
It could affect the play of the opposing team, so much so that they banned it in this professional sports league. You being able to do that,
you can't do that.
You cannot paint the.
You're making these guys babies.
So, that shows me that there is actually science behind, like, sitting in a pink room before you play sports could actually affect your play, and therefore all this feng shui could actually make even a minute difference.
Dousing rod.
Color. When it comes to color alone, There are studies. People who drive yellow cars get more speeding tickets. Get more speeding tickets. Now, that's no accident. That is no accident. When you're driving a yellow car, you're staring at yellow. And you're like, I just feel like driving faster. I just feel like school driving bus. Faster.
That's weird. Yeah. I thought it was red. Wasn't it red car?
It used to be red.
I think so red gets more accidents,
so
right?
2007 was red, man. 2022, it's yellow.
Hold on. Red is about someone, the police officers noticing the car. The yellow is about the psychological aspect of speeding through a yellow light.
What about the Monster Energy drink green? Where does that rank? Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So here's the thing. If you want success, you need royal blue. Royal blue is the color for success. If you want to bring in abundance and money, it's royal blue and gold.
Royal blue.
You need like Donald Trump, like that gaudy gold color. You need that everywhere in your house. You need all of your picture frames to be
gold, bright gold. Okay, yeah, it'll be a look like Caesar's Palace.
We are. We're going that far.
You're all gaudy pictures.
Literally,
of
it's literally like you're standing in. I'm trying to think of somebody in Vegas. Like old Vegas.
Yes.
Engelbert Humperdinck's bathroom.
Here's another thing.
Engelbert Humperdinck's
really
bathroom.
You have to pay attention to where your mirrors are in your house. Where your mirrors are.
Ceiling and the top of my shoes.
Where all mirrors should
be. Yeah, the only place for mirrors. Ceiling, top of shoes. Up the skirt.
And if they're pointing toward a toilet... Or toward a stove.
Who wants to look at themselves on the toilet?
Well, speak for yourself. It's the only way I can see if everything got done. It's called the Ralphie Man.
If the reflection in a mirror goes down the drain, be careful.
Wait, so if you take a mirror and point it towards
the doo-doo monster.
They did a monster three times.
Literally, the Candyman shows up and he's like, "Where's Jason's poverty hole?"
So why aren't you supposed to have a mirror pointed towards the toilet?
It will literally take all of the energy that goes in the room and it will flush it.
Yeah, so
it will flush it right down the toilet.
It's either the toilet or drains. Anywhere that things drain from the house, that it drains that energy. That the drains are actually magnets for the energy in the house.
So you got to plug up all your drains with mirrors.
So we kind of found that our sex life had kind of been a little stale.
What? Yeah, you put that mirror over the toilet, and I bet that'll splash things up. Yeah, that's called the McAfee.
And anyway, so when I was taking this class, the woman says, "What kind of painting or picture do you have above your bed?" And I had this giant elephant, because y'all know my story about the elephant in the in Africa.
It's above, like on the ceiling?
No, just above the headboard.
You think all the paintings and things in my house are big? This elephant is ginormous, right? It's like the size of a wall. And anyway, she literally said, "Oh my God, like no man could get an erection with an elephant that big above your bed."
So hold my bear.
All the onus on me.
The ED elephant.
So the lady was telling it, she's like, "Oh my God, this is horrible. No one can maintain an erection around this pachyderm."
So it was giving Jason ED.
Such a fascinating course. It has just been.
I feel like we're gonna hit best of.
So wait, did you throw the elephant out and now he's a
what was the result?
Yes. The elephant needs to go in the wisdom corner of
wisdom
your house.
Corner? That's a...
Hold on, where's that?
I was like, above the toilet. Duh, why didn't we think of that?
So what goes in the boner corner?
Don't you never talk about boner.
The southwest corner
of the
house.
And now we have a flagpole behind the bed.
Hey now. It just felt good, right? It felt like it needed a hey now.
Yeah.
It felt old school.
And
that's not mine. And that's totally stolen, but it felt like I was tipping my hat. I was tipping my hat to Father Stern.
Through a flagpole joke. So, no, but what did you replace it? Like, what is good for that above the headboard of your bed?
Okay, so the bedroom, it depends what you're looking for. If you're looking for romance, then you want something in pairs. You always want something in pairs. Birds, pictures of lovebirds.
All right.
Pictures of, actually, they said the dragon and the falcon.
The dragon and the falcon, of course. Yeah, they're the morning show team across the street.
So is it all about, in, because, you know, you say feng shui, we make fun of it because it seems like it's magic and mumbo jumbo, but it's just really like tiny psychological cues that your brain picks up subconsciously that may affect your behavior.
Do you know what it is? Mm. It is a 3D vision board. It is literally making your entire house into exactly what you want to create in your life.
I see what you're saying.
If you want to create travel, then you put pictures of where you want to go. If you want to put, if you want family to be your biggest value, then you put pictures of your kids and your wife. You put what's important to you.
That's kind of what you've done.
You literally put everything in your house needs to have a reason and a symbol. Here's the other thing. Sometimes we hold on to things because they were given to us, or we hold on to them because they're a family heirloom, or we hold on to them because my mom made it.
Yeah.
We might need it someday.
We might need it
yeah,
someday.
Yeah, I have a lot
and
of that.
Literally, it creates clutter. We walk by it every day and we're like, ugh.
Yeah.
I really don't love it, but I keep it because, you know yeah. what? If I get rid of it, I'm getting rid of my mom's love.
Or you're a bad person if you get rid of it. Like, I wanted to throw out my mom and dad's ashes, and Andrea's like, you can't do that. And I'm like, well, what are they doing? Are they serving me any purpose whatsoever? They're just taking up room in my video game room.
There's actually, I think it's the west side of the house is where you should put all of the dead people. That's the okay. That's the side of the house where you should put the angels and the isn't it the west?
I don't remember which side it is. I've got a notebook that's
yeah. So
get out your dead person notebook and tell me where to put. No, I'm kidding. I'm joking.
What about your backyard?
You can feng that.
Like, can you feng shui outdoor areas?
Oh yes, sir.
Yes, and fire, like there's places for fire,
yeah,
there's places for water, there's places for wind, there's places, I mean, even every entrance of your house has a meaning. And, oh, I learned today, this is what I learned right before I got on with you guys.
All right.
You should enter through the garage. Do you guys enter your house through the garage?
I do, actually,
yes, yeah.
All right, well, you should never exit your house through the garage.
Oh, I always exit through, I exit through the gift shop. No, I always exit through the garage. I always exit through the garage. It's the only entrance I have to my... You know, I thought about the other night, if my house starts burning, there's only two doors to get out of it.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
so I made a new one.
Here's what I like about going in and out of the garage is because it makes me feel like Batman because it's a door.
Very that, good.
No. Like, it's a door that's an automatic door.
No, only if you...
And
okay,
I like that.
Only if you do this move and tell me if you do this move, and I guarantee you don't do this move because you can't pull your car or truck in your garage. I do this move now where I get in my car, I hit the button from my car, it goes up while I'm in it, and it started, and there's fumes in the garage.
No.
And I back out, and then I hit the button, and then when I pull in, and then I hit the button while I'm still in it, and the car's still on, and it closes like a bat cave.
Oh, yeah. And then you're like, should I leave it on a little longer? Anyway, so why, like, okay, so if you leave through the garage,
yes.
What kind of ghosts get you?
Well, kings and queens do not exit through the garage.
Oh, that's what peasants do. I like this whole
other thing. Wait a minute. So we shouldn't exit. We shouldn't enter.
And here's another little fun fact for you. Like right now, where you guys are sitting in your studio.
Yeah.
Daniel is in the power position.
Of course I am.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Of course
that's
I am.
That's how
I
planned it.
Yeah. That's the way.
Yes, whoever
yeah,
can
we
funged
it this way.
The doorway. And who can see the people entering and exiting the room, that is the power position.
What's
time
in
the
position?
Worst position?
No, you can still see the door.
Nah, it's around the corner. He can see the door.
Around the corner. Yeah. Fudge is made.
I like keeping my back to all doors. Like, yeah, I like being surprised.
Yeah.
Like, I like not knowing who's coming.
Yeah. What's that? Oh, hi.
Because I'm a naturally optimistic person. I think whoever's coming is here to give me a prize.
Oh, it's a clown with a TV.
Nothing else. Me and Daniel have made this joke forever. We think anybody who's standing, like, you don't notice they're standing behind you, has a birthday cake for you.
They're happy for you. Yeah.
But then you're talking ass about them, huh?
Yeah. Yeah, normally we have this vision of we're talking cash ass about it. Like, we could even be talking ass about you, Jana, but you'd be behind us holding a birthday cake, about to give it to us, and then you just slowly, go away.
We laugh at that all the time.
So sad.
So I did remember in the meeting we had about the person telling us that your desk or whatever, like if you're in the room.
Well, she said, don't put your logo. This is one thing. This is a real one. She said, do not put your logo on a carpet or a rug because is that how you want to... Do you want to be stepping on your logo? Do you want to be showing your logo, the bottom of your feet? That's no respect.
Yeah, yeah. That was immediately the inspiration for us making a carpet. Yeah, that was.
We were like, let's try this. First thing we did, we got our rugs.
We're going to do the exact opposite of everything this person says.
It is kind of true. Did you learn that about the logos or about...
Well, there is something about your... It does say no carpet when you first enter a room. No carpet when you first enter a room. And you want your logo to be something that you want to have when you first enter the entrance of a house or the entrance of your office, because that's something you want to create. You want that in your success.
It's basically what you want to broadcast to yourself every day. It's almost like when you walk into to your house, the first room in your house or inside that doorway should have everything you want to become or that you're trying to bring towards your life. Like if you have books of knowledge, gold, those types of colors around. So like gold, blue, forest green.
Yeah.
That's cool. Yeah, I'm not sure I buy all of it, but I definitely...
There's some sort of psychological science or psychology behind little, inceptions, right? Because that's all it is like little cues that...
Keep you on task, keep you executing.
They remind you.
This is what I think. I think where your focus goes is really... how your life starts to develop, like what you choose to focus on. And that's kind of what we've decided. You know, there's like a reticular activating system that kicks in. Jana Banana, that's like the perfect example. Bananas have come up in every area of my life, my entire life. Now, do I really think that bananas are magical, or do I think that, you know, they are sending me signals, or do I think that there's some sort of connection to the divine?
Yeah.
No, probably not. But for some reason, they catch my attention and I pay attention when I see bananas. And so it's almost like, I don't know who it is that says when you choose to see miracles, everything becomes a miracle. Or if you choose to see everything...
You either see everything as a miracle or nothing as a miracle.
Yeah.
No, that's our show. That's our show.
Yeah.
I think you know.
It's kind of like choosing the perspective that you want to see.
Right.
So in your house, if you start planting all of these things for your subconscious to pay attention to, then when you go out into the real world and you start seeing money... or the opportunities, your reticular activating system kicks in.
More open to seeing it and more readily available to you.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. It does make sense.
And we'll end with this because it's something that kind of ties in that my wife does, but it's insane. And it's the 11:34. I've told you about this.
Oh,
right?
The clock thing. She did it here one day and it freaked me out. She screamed it from the couch.
I know.
11:34! I'm like, isn't that Jim Carrey movie where he ends up writing one number all over his house and then he kills everybody or something?
So... my entire life of knowing my wife, she's always brought up the fact that she looks at the clock just so happens to be 11:34 in morning or night, and like she'll be like, "Oh, looked at the clock. Guess what time it was?" and then so that obviously some
has she ever hit 11:35?
Upside down, it spells hell, right? And then so she's brought this up for 20 years, right?
Wait
and,
a minute, I like this. This is this
what does she think it means?
This is the type of feng shui I want. This is the feng we all need. Is the devil's inside the microwave? 11:34. 11:34.
And then
devil in the microwave.
And then every single time she brings it up, I'm like, yeah, it's because that's stuck in your head, and you just so happen to notice. And you
that's straight up Beelzebub in the microwave. That is, and then she's like, what's his name? Mephistopheles.
And her argument is like, no, I don't look at the clock all the time, but just so every time I happen to like think about
it's
looking
Satan
at the clock,
turning her head. It's Satan. He touches her chin and he just turns her head gently to this. I look at the numbers. Hold on, I can do it. I can do a really good Satan. Hold on, I do this.
Look at the numbers, 11:34.
And then we go into the discussion. Well, okay, if it's not just your brain because you remember 11:34 and you happen to look at the clock at that time,
then what is
and
it?
That's a, then on the opposite of that, it's the devil. Somehow,
it's the devil
inside your brain. He's giving you a like, hey, your entire life, I'm going to curse you.
We have case studies, sir.
Devil went of a curse.
Devil went down to Georgia for the gold. We have
minor inconveniences. Not even inconveniences.
You automatically go to the devil's bringing you to that. Have you Googled angel numbers? And
angel numbers.
I've Googled some angel numbers.
Me too. 69.
Yeah, those Columbia angel numbers.
I've Googled lots of things.
Yeah, I think I know angel numbers, sir. She is a sweet woman.
Now, what is that?
So it's just like, so our number, or Jana's number is 104. Which
that ain't no angel number to you. Sorry,
it's crazy. I know where you're going with that, but it's amazing where we see it and where it pops up, and it's over and over and over again. So some people are their reticular activating system sees that number everywhere, and there's a reason for it. And I would actually Google what 11:34 is in angel numbers, or what
Sam, Google that. Is it really Beelzebub?
It might be. It could be Beelzebub, Mephistopheles. Okay.
The 11:34 numerology.
Oh.
Has precisely appeared to you, and you wonder what does 11:34 mean. Indeed, you have a message from the divine beings. Angel number 11:34 is a compilation of the vibrations of number one appearing twice, amplifying its influences with the energies of number three and number four. Angel number 11:34 brings a message to focus on the divine spark within yourself and manifest your desires.
That's dumb and vague. Hold on.
Focus internally and manifest your desires.
And it also answered something like you answered something. It was like number one, 1,134 is two ones, a three, and a four. I'm like, oh, thanks a lot. I know that. I'm looking for the angel number. I want the mysticism.
If you want the symbolic meaning, it says if you keep seeing 11:34 everywhere, it should be prudent not to allow anxiety and doubts to paralyze your progress towards your goals. Stay focused and persistent instead of watching things happen.
It's because you guys are ungodly. You guys aren't right with God. I'm reading it right here.
Get out of the familiar zone and never focus on past failures to make your life better.
The 11:34 angel number indicates that it would be wise to seek divine help to stay motivated and inspired all the way. Your angels will remain closer to you to ensure you succeed in life if you pray to God to conquer your fear, hardships, discomfort, or uncertainties.
Well, does it say which one? Because we didn't know.
You got to go. I don't know. Who's got the most people? Go Buddha. Right?
No. I think it's another one. Anyway, Jana and Jason plug
can
your guys'
show. Can I stay at your house tonight? Like, what are you doing? I didn't know what you were going to ask.
He wants to stay in Wisdom Corner.
The Jana and Jason show. When do you actually broadcast it?
We are going live every morning at 6:55, and then we have a coaching community that meets on Thursdays at 2:30, and it is growing exponentially. So we are so excited because we've had some really incredible transformations. And if you'd like to join that group, it's on Facebook. And you can...
Facebook.com/groups/spinpositive.
All right. Cool. That's awesome.
Yes. And we have some really, really big things coming up in the next couple months. So join the group because I think we had 200 people join just over the weekend.
Wow.
So it's really fun and exciting right now.
Cool. Awesome. Well, Jana, Jason, thanks so much for talking to us.
Yeah, good Thank seeing you. You guys.
And good luck with everything. We'll talk to you next month, okay?
All right. You guys rock. Feng Thank shui. You so much.
Okay, and a feng shui to use. Oh, sorry.
Like, I understand the psychology behind the feng shui.
Oh, yeah.
It's just when you get super deep into energies and stuff like that, I just start laughing.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I can't take it seriously.
When we get to the point, when we get to the very end and it's a salt crystal, I'm kind of like,
No, that's my favorite part.
Really? You like the end?
Yeah, I just wait.
I like the journey more because I can see value in Wisdom Corner. I can see value in moving the elephant so I can get an erection. Like, I can see all of that.
See, to me, it seems like just the pure act of trying to get into things that are like self-help means that you're going to help yourself, right? And I think the pessimism.
I think you're right.
Most people like us, we look at it and we make fun of it and stuff. But also, it's not going to change someone's life if they don't want it to. Just like all the stuff, right? So if you want to feng shui your house to make
you
your house better,
you have to opt in. It's just like religion, right?
Yes, exactly, you have to opt in. But also, but with religion too, there's tons of positives. Like obviously, it's like the discipline of it, the wanting to make yourself better will make you better.
Well, look,
that's the secret. It's like, hey, think about positivity. Think about what you want your goals to be, and you'll get them.
Correct.
Which is true, but the problem is, it's not. It takes a lot of hard work and you wanting to do it. Which is the same thing with
also
like...
Also, saying that is not cool. You know, like, I know we have people that like hearing from them. We have people that will listen to Jana and Jason and be like, I'm not sure I believe in that. And in a lot of ways, what's funny is that the way that I am always with this type of thing, with, like, let's say, like, uber positivity or, like, positivity as a kind of, like, a career choice is
or, like,
that,
motivational.
Yeah, like, motivational is that, like, what is it doing for the people that are doing it? Like, they're doing it because they feel like they need it. Yeah, so who am I to, like, be like, well, you don't need that. You know what I mean? Like, that's not that's not even my mind to decide. You know? I mean, it may not work for me. Of course. Well, everybody's is a case by case.
It's kind of like diet pills. Like, they give you the pill, and they're like, take this pill and eat right and exercise, and you'll lose weight, right? It's like, so it's not the magic pill, but sometimes people need.
It's the follow through.
People need the pill as a motivator to eat right and exercise, which is really the reason why it's working, right? So it's like,
correct.
It's not the way you position your furniture why you're more successful. It's the fact that you even took the opportunity or the time or the experience to learn about what position your furniture should be in.
Right.
And that means you are motivated to be successful, and therefore that is the why.
That's you're the act.
Yeah, it's the act. It's not magic.
Yep.
It's that, right?
We've been working on this. This year has been the year of us discovering why people opt into doing these type of things. I think we're getting there.
Yeah, yeah. Because it's easy to hate on it or say like, oh, that's BS.
It's the easiest thing to do.
But if you just look into it a little bit, you're like, oh, okay, I see.
You could make the same argument for therapy or certain kinds of therapy.
It's the same thing.
You know, I'm going there today, but there are plenty of people that are like, oh, you don't need that. On the Peloton boards forever, there's a hashtag that says cheaper than therapy. The funny thing about that is both are good. You know, yeah, they'll say that.
That's a terrible hashtag.
It is a terrible hashtag when you think about it, because the two are not the same.
Mm-mm.
You can't even, now, I get mental benefits from exercising? Absolutely.
Sure.
But they're not the same. You can't say they're the same.
They aren't the same, but I guess it's like, if you're not going to do either, or if you're going to do one, maybe the exercise would be better.
More cost effective. Sure.
Or cost effective and also help you psychologically a little bit, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. But some people don't even believe in therapy. Like, some people just think that, no, that's unnecessary, doesn't do anything.
Well, I think, you know, it's kind of like I've done therapy before and stuff. It just doesn't seem to work
Well, you also only went to one therapist. Sometimes you gotta test them out, see who fits best for you.
I've been to two.
He knows.
And
I was like, didn't he tell us all he did was talk at them?
Yes. I just
have to really talk
like
to
we're your
it.
Therapy. Was it you it's just alone? Like Seth.
No.
Was
you're
it
right.
you by yourself?
Yes. Yeah. I did it a couple times, and then but it's beneficial because it's just me talking it out, and most of the time it's me. Talking it out and figuring it out on my own, which is most of the time therapy, is like you're talking to someone you pay to listen to you, which is rare in your life. And then I started to understand, I'm like, oh, this person's just sitting here and listening to me for 45 minutes, talk about whatever, and then I feel better after. Or sometimes I talk out a situation because no one usually in your life is willing to sit there and intently listen for 45 minutes.
It's a chore. Yeah, it can be a chore. It's your spouse, heavy stuff. Yeah.
Your spouse is everybody and your friend. And no one really is that good of a listener unless you have a therapist-like friend that is really engaging into listening to you. Most people aren't like that.
Right.
So then it's like, then I got it. I was like, okay, that makes sense to me.
Like here, if I had something to lay on somebody, I got nobody here. Maybe Sam, but she's got stuff she's working out. I don't need to give her my stuff. I don't need to saddle her with my business. I would never choose you, though, my God.
Yeah.
No, that's actually, it's a joke. He's probably one of the best listeners you could ever find.
But I escape.
Naturally.
I'm not listening.
No, I was going to say, he looks like he's listening.
But it doesn't matter, right? Because what am I getting
out of
it?
Fake it till you make it, yeah.
I mean, think about it. Like, what if it's for me, right? I mean, he's really good. You can lay some heavy stuff on him, and he will be unaffected, I promise you.
Well, that I've learned from my wife, where I just shut up and stop trying to fix the... because, like,
right. Well, I had to learn that from you.
That's from being married for so long that I just learned it. Like, when someone's telling me their problems...
You told me that.
Sometimes people are just venting.
Venting, yes. And Daniel, he's done that before, too, where he just needs to vent something to me, and it makes him feel better. It's hard for me to not... tell you what I think you should do or what the right answer
is. Oh, I want you to tell me.
But I just have to just sit there and listen, and that's the process that you're trying to get through. Now you're not trying to find an answer. You're venting something.
It's hard for me to do that with Andrea. She'll tell me these things, and I know how to fix them, and it just breaks my heart to see how stupid she is.
I know it breaks my heart.
I'm like, God, but I gotta let her learn.
I know how to fix every problem that anybody's telling
She'll
me.
She'll tell me something. I'm like, this is amateur hour over here, and she's telling me, she's like, I don't want you to help me. I just want to tell you, and I'm like, oh, but if you let me help you, I can fix this in like 1 minute. You dumb dumb. But she doesn't do it. You know. We can do some voicemails.
Yes.
Here.
Hey guys, Hilton Head BDM here. Until I listen to your ACT. I thought the Sublime song always said Papa Cap and Sancho, and I smack her in the mouth. I know that's crazy now that I think about it. And one of my favorites of all time was when I caught my friend in high school Smashing Pumpkins. He used to say, spying on my raindrops, I'm still just a rat in a cage. And we had when I caught him saying that, we laughed for years.
Spying on my raindrops.
Huh.
That's pretty good. Spying on my raindrops. I'm still just...
People just like to add syllables in
there. Yeah, because it's despite all my rage, right?
Yeah.
Despite
all my rage, I am still just...
Spying on my raindrops. Despite all my rage. That's pretty good.
Although I have raindrops, it seems like despite all my rage... Not rain, like it's two syllables there.
What's the one, Cherub Rock? What's the chorus of that where it goes, who wants, and that?
I don't know what that is. I mean, there's one in there, I'm not getting it from what you're saying.
There's one in there that I used to get wrong in Smashing Pumpkins.
I don't know a ton of Smashing Pumpkins. I wasn't a big fan.
Oh, I got one.
A little before your time, too.
That I thought was different. You know, okay, this is going to be a deep dive.
Deep dive it.
There is a girl that sings.
There's a girl who.
She's British, and it's a song that doesn't really have any instruments. It's just her. It's kind of a cappella, but it has like, and it's
Imogen Heap.
No. It's like 3 or 4 years ago.
Lily Allen.
No. It's about I'm not that fancy. Oh God, what is it?
So fancy.
No.
Iggy Azalea.
I'm not that fancy.
No. It's my address. Oh God, the chat room will know. It's
Reba McEntire.
Oh, wait. Lord.
Lord! There Lord.
She's not British.
Oh, okay. Lord. It's the Lord.
How did I get that? God, I speak Tom so
that
good now.
That was good. Okay. That was really good.
She's what? From New Zealand.
It was Royals, right?
Yes. I've never
seen it. That was not 3 years ago. It was like 10
no,
years
yeah,
ago.
Yeah, it was a long ass time.
Jesus Christ, dude. 3 years ago.
She's a grown woman now.
Yeah, I think she's like, she's a grandma now. This is Grandma Lord.
Oh, I'll tell you what I thought.
Came out in 2013 when you uploaded your last profile picture.
I'm muffing a lot of likes, social.
Okay, I'll tell you.
What about it? What did you think she said?
We'll get to it.
Oh, okay.
Here we go.
This was a good song.
It was a
man.
Good song. Affair, and we'll never be royals.
It's a run in our blood. That kind of love just ain't for us. How much? We crave a different
kind of bug. Let me I thought it, we craved a different kind of bugs.
Now, why would you think?
We crave a different kind of bugs. Mosquitoes are boring.
And I thought she was referencing that rich people eat lobsters.
Oh,
listen
wow.
to that overthinking.
Damn.
And she was
so
saying.
He said something earlier in the office where we're like, well, wow, our brains would have never went to that.
No,
you
it
overthink
was, it was
everything.
Like a super paranoid thing. And he's
yeah.
like, I didn't want to do
about
that.
About putting because, something in
yeah,
the closet. Yeah.
You know, I didn't want to do that because I'd be disrespectful to him if people walked at A, B, C, D,
right.
E,
and we're like, whoa, I never would have
yeah,
ever thought
like,
of that.
No one will connect that, dude.
And this guy's thinking that rich people eat lobsters. They crave a different type of
well,
bug.
Well, she's saying we crave a
different
type
of bug.
We're
like lobster. We're rich.
No, because the rich people like lobsters, but we, the poor,
what do they like? Shrimp. They like shrimp. We're
yes.
shrimp people.
Popcorn shrimp.
Well, yes, we're Popeye's popcorn shrimp.
I didn't know. I thought, you
Lord
know.
Lord for Popeye's popcorn shrimp. They've replaced the Popeye's lady with Lord. Pasty white girl with hair down to her waist.
But you look like a ghost.
Oh, my God. Have you, do you even That's know what popcorn it. Shrimp is?
That's how stupid I am.
That's a good one. Yeah. I'm.
What like, is the?
We crave a different type of buzz. Like oh, you know, getting okay. screwed up.
Yeah.
God, that should have been your first guess. You love getting screwed up, right?
Right.
Well, I don't know. I mean, what kind of buzz does do? I thought poor and rich people both like OxyContin.
You're yeah. not wrong.
Based on that fact, I'm like,
but,
okay.
But poor people can't eat lobster. Too expensive. Right. We crave popcorn.
Makes perfect.
Perfect sense. There it is. I told him. Guad. Anyway.
Guad.
Guad. Guad. Are you okay?
Oh, I didn't sleep well last night.
Bye-bye.
Welcome to A Corporate Time with Tom and Dan. I'm Tom.
I am Dan. We are live on Twitch right now, Monday through Friday, guys. If you want to watch us, if you like the video component of what we have, you can watch us live as we work from our studio in Baldwin Park. Just go to twitch.tv/TomandDanLive. Everything is on there. And yeah, you can chat, you can watch, you can participate. It's really cool.
Also, we're doing BDM Appreciation Week starting April 17th. That's Tom and Dan Day. The whole week, we're sending out prizes to BDMs, mailing them to you personally. We've got some big prizes. I know Daniel already secured a Nintendo Switch.
Mm-hmm. The new one.
I think we're buying some Oculuses today and some other. They're going to be gift cards. And
Oculi.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Oculi. And a bunch of different things, all the way down to you'll get a personal thank you card with a sticker in it at least. But we're going to mail out over 1,000 things that week. So if you want to become a BDM, it's at TomandDan.com. If you're already a BDM, just make sure your address is correct at TomandDan.com.
Indeed.
Because we don't want it coming back to us if we want you to get the prize.
There you go. Let's try this one.
Hey, gang. It's Zach from Ohio. Would you guys bang an old lady, like, 70-plus? I guess it would obviously depend on the person, but how old of a lady would you bang?
Doesn't matter. Applies to me as banging a lady or banging a dude?
Yeah, dude.
Because it differentiates.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you can go dude.
You can go dude.
All right, I'll go dude.
Just go whatever you want, right? Boy, girl, whatever you want in the scenario.
I guess it just depends on the
how
person.
They look.
Yeah. Like, because there
old
are.
Old men are grosser than old ladies, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, hairy.
I can't really comment, though, because I don't know. real old ladies' hygiene? I think it's case by case for me, I'd like to think I'm the type of person.
Is there a cutoff? How about that?
No.
No cutoff?
No, it's case by case with no cutoff. If I get there and I survey the scenario and I think that you're I deem you worthy of laying with me.
69 cutoff.
I think
the age? Yeah. No age. No, you could be a good-looking 80.
Have you seen, like, Robert Redford before he passed away? Like, I think he
didn't look bad.
Like, that is a handsome gentleman.
Well, you look at Christie Brinkley now, because old episodes of Parks and Rec were on, and she plays Jerry's wife in Parks and Recreation.
He died at 85.
Christie Brinkley. Christie Brinkley is, how old is Christie Brinkley?
Well, yeah, she looks amazing.
She's in her 60s, I think, but early 60s, I think.
Yeah, so if you're like a Christie Brinkley, I mean, you know.
Yeah, she's
68. She's almost 70 years old.
She looks amazing.
She does look amazing.
I'd have sex with Christie.
So would
Christie
I.
Brinkley.
I'd have sex with Christie from Christie Knows Best. I'll have sex with Mr. Christie from Christie Knows Best.
Where's Christner?
Here's why it's easier for women and easier for Sam. And
all right.
It's because every once in a while, I stumble on these movies called Old OJ. It's
OJ.
I stumble upon it.
It's ODJE. It's like OJ. Right?
OJ.
It's OJ.
It's OJ.
And it's more artistic and it's European.
Yeah.
I can tell by their language.
The way they talk, they're always like,
And when I see these movies,
you there, girl, standing next to the picnic table. Do you have any money?
Get a book and have a So, okay, follow me here. Here's why it's easier for women, because in these movies I watch, they can do certain positions where they don't even have to look at what they're doing and who they're doing it with. And like,
I don't know what you mean.
Like reverse cowgirl, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they're just staring off into the woods on the picnic table.
Do we get that? Yeah, doggy. We get that.
Yes, but we're not
looking. Which is the same position, really.
It would be the same if our heads were turned the opposite way.
Just don't look down, right?
Yeah, now.
Or look up like you do.
Yeah, but in the reverse cowgirl, like, I guess you see the old legs.
Old feet, all spotty, age spots, smooth calves.
We got to be careful how we tread here, but you would have to eliminate a lot of the
yellow toenails.
Your face-to-face positions you'd have to eliminate.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because you don't want to see the chest. You don't want to see the breasts. You don't want to see the belly.
Yeah. But I guess in the back.
We did make an error. Robert Redford's not dead. He is still alive.
No. Okay.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Well, but now if he does die, we will get called by Inside Edition.
Nah. In a couple years, this will work.
God, well, why did I think Robert Redford passed? Who was
I don't know, but
of?
I believed you.
I went to hell with you, sir. I was ready to go.
You know who it was? I get him confused with the sauce guy.
Paul Newman.
Paul Newman, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Paul Newman,
I
can see
that. I like that you called him the sauce guy instead of like the race car guy.
Boy, that's really got to chat Paul Newman's ass.
I know.
He's the salad dressing guy.
And Socceroonie's real good.
And not the car guy.
I see more sauces than race cars.
Socceroonie is good.
It is good.
Socceroonie is good.
Bad.
It's not bad at all. For a store-bought sauce that isn't Rao's or Rao's, it's not bad at all.
All right, let's try another one.
All right, let's try this one.
Hey guys, this is Ben with a Y here. I was just listening to the Friday Free Show. We were talking about how did you know about bands and when they were playing before the internet. And I can remember there used to be a staple music store in just about every mall. And I can't remember the name of it now.
Sam Goody?
FYE.
FYE, Sam Goody.
That was the one at the Florida Mall.
What were the other ones we had at the mall? Camelot music?
Camelot
was one.
I think there was a Camelot.
I think Camelot was
Mall.
Before my time.
Yeah, we had Camelot. You'd go in there if you wanted to.
Peaches.
That's a good one.
But you would go there, and there you could actually purchase tickets.
Yeah.
We had one in DeLand.
Ticketmaster.
Specs Music, and it had a ticket counter. They had a ticket counter you'd go up to, and their ticket counter guy was always like the metalhead. And then the lady would work the CDs, and you go up to the ticket counter. It was intimidating. I was like, one ticket to Faith No More, sir.
And he's like, what do you know?
Like, Faith No More, huh? I don't know which albums you like. You probably only listen to Epic, nerd. Yeah, like that kind of a thing. And I'm like, actually, sir, I love the album Angel Dust. Oh, an Angel Dust guy. Okay.
Where, okay, at Guitar Center or Sam Ash, that's where the last, like,
metalheads live?
Metalhead guys work, right?
Yes.
There's no more, because there's no more
that
CD stores.
That or Amazon.
Oh, that's a sad one.
I think it's all metalheads.
Amazon, where else?
Yeah, I think you get a lot of, like, everybody in there, but a lot of metalheads, right? Because, like, you got these guys that don't care what job they have as long as they can still rock out on the job. And what I mean, they're, like, have long hair, right? Not everybody's going to let you have long hair.
Or tattoos.
Tattoos. Also, another thing that
so
they like.
So any warehouse job, really.
Even more than tattoos, your metalheads like your leather Viking bracers on their arms. You know, like, they like to wear things that you shouldn't properly wear. Like, they're wearing PacSun jeans, but they have a long, like, a Viking chain that comes down to a small like a tactical hatchet that's on their belt. And I'm like, why do you have that? It's like, because they like the, they like everything that's like whimsical dragons and.
They do not like dressing professional.
No.
That, yeah, they're anti-suits and stuff. Like, I knew a person that like, I'll never wear a suit.
Oh, yeah, I know that same guy, yeah.
And they're like, really?
Jeans and Oakley brand sneakers. Jeans and Oakley brand sneakers. That's all they wear, metalheads.
Yeah, yeah.
And the Oakley brand is because normally metalheads are tall. And when you're tall, you have big feet. And Oakley was one of the only companies that makes really big shoes.
I feel bad for metalheads because they're like...
Especially in Florida. They wear all black. They have long hair.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Got the chains.
So hot.
Hot chains. Yeah. Chains in the sun.
Yeah. Oof.
And, but also like the places that they love to work, like... The Sam Ash or Guitar Centers, I imagine, are
I think they're a little
up,
more,
right?
Yeah, I went into Sam Ash to buy drumsticks because I have that drum set now.
Just everybody ordering
way,
online.
We can talk about this for a second. I had an old man moment. I'm walking through Sam Ash, walking all up and down, walking the drum aisle, looking for drumsticks. Can't find them anywhere. Walking the back, can't find no drumsticks. I'm like, oh my God, pandemic, no drumsticks. It must have, no wood, nope. People are just so bad. That they don't even keep drumsticks out. It used to be when I was a...
Oh, people would steal them?
Yep. When I was a proper, like, when it mattered to me to drum, when I wanted to drum, when I professionally drum, you know, when I was buying sticks all the time, you would get to walk in and they'd have a drum pad set up and you could test sticks and feel feel how they, you know, they'd have stuff. Nope, that's all gone. People ruined it because they steal drumsticks.
To the point where they don't even put them out?
They're all behind the counter. You can't even get back there. So I had to ask the guy, and he's like, you'll have to ask me what you want. And I was like, just give me some 5A's. I don't even care anymore. Because part of the fun of going there and using this, it's an experience.
And when, let me ask you this. I know when you went in there, how many customers were actually
me?
There? Right.
Me?
Just take them out from behind the goddamn counter.
No, people are stealing them. So I said, I was defeated. I like had a moment with my wife. She's like, well, that was fast. I was like, yeah, they don't have drumsticks out. So I just said, give me what I play, which are 5As. I'm like, just give me two pairs of 5As. That's all I need. And I'll be out of here. Dude, they're expensive as hell now. $14 a
pair. Yeah, wood is crazy.
God.
I remember in the 90s when I used to go into Guitar Center because, like, me and my friends would just wander around there. And, like, that's what you did, around strip malls or whatever. You pop into Guitar Center, play some instruments.
You get a smoothie, walk over to Guitar Center.
There was a room that just had, like, lights and fog machines.
Yeah. DJ room.
And then the pianos. Yeah, the DJ. Do they still have that?
They still have the DJ room.
They have
actually,
to,
the DJ room is bigger than most of the other rooms because a lot of very untalented people can DJ. A lot of talented people can too, but also I don't mean that to be
the lighting
shade,
and
really.
Stuff doesn't necessarily always have to be for DJs too. So there's like a lot of other stuff.
Bands
in there.
Buy it, wedding people buy it. You know, you might buy it for your house if you have a karaoke machine. You know, you might have a nice setup.
Probably easier to learn or easier to be a beginner.
I gotta see Seth set up for his karaoke.
He says it's severe.
I want to go one time.
I'm just afraid for you to go over there alone.
He's
well, I'm gonna bring weapons with me for sure.
Yeah,
he's not gonna attack you. He said it was you.
I don't know. Let's try this one.
Hey guys, Hilton Head BDM here. To the gentleman who called and tried to distinguish that. Genital herpes cannot be on the mouth and mouth herpes cannot be on the genitals. You are an idiot. And you are absolutely wrong. Use that computer in your hand you're using to call into the show. Use it to simply Google and the CDC will inform you.
Now, there's your problem right there, God.
Fauci's not going to tell me about the goddamn herpes.
Fauci got herpes.
What makes you feel better, sir, that you think that your mouth herpes are not genital and your genital herpes are not mouth herpes, sir, but they are. You probably have all six of them. So
what, there's six kinds of herpes?
Just stop spreading misinformation.
Okay, I thought
there are different strands, but they can transfer. So oral herpes caused by HSV-1 can spread from the mouth to the genitals through oral sex.
Can we change the name of all of these?
Well, how do you know which one you have down there? Like, I would
say I got mouth on myself and I got self on my mouth.
Yeah, what if someone had both opposite?
Yeah, like, yeah, what if you get them mixed up?
I've got mouth herpes downstairs and I've got downstairs herpes on my lips.
Because I would tell anybody I was with, I'm like, no, don't worry. Those are the mouth.
Don't worry, it's just mouth herpes.
That's HSV-1.
Yeah.
Not HSV-2.
How'd you get...
All right. Next one.
Okay. Our buddy Izzy. You know Izzy.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
Chungus, Glorioso.
Hey, Tom and Dan, Samantha. How's it going? I'm recording this. I mean, Izzy here. I'm recording this.
He's so cute.
Before you guys went on vacay, or the Friday you guys just went on vacay, but talking about saving lives, I remember this one time. I was like 9, 8 years old. It was up in Wyman Beach, up in Boston, Rhode Island. It was Lake Constituent and then Wyman Beach. I remember Wyman Beach had arcades and everything. And we were all at the lake. You know how Puerto Ricans' families do it? They had music, the trunks open with the doors and the speakers going, music, arroz con pollo.
Oh yeah, buddy.
All the food, you know how it is. You know how they deal with the speakers and stuff. Anyways, well, my dad was drunk and
yes.
I was with my cousin Ingrid and we were walking around the shore and all of a sudden I see this floating thing, you know, something floating on the shore. And when we get closer, it's my dad. He was floating in the shore. It's nothing to laugh about. But he was super drunk, and he was just floating in the water, laying back, and he was drowning. And I remember I remember pulling him up and, you know, grabbing him by his arms. I was 8 years old. My dad is a big old man, and I'm lifting him up, and, you know.
You're triggering a core memory, Izzy.
And I started beating on his chest, CPR. And my cousin Ingrid went screaming for my uncles, and all my uncles and aunts came running. And all of my son and my dad started spitting out water, came back too. And, you know, he
salsaed on down the line.
Oh my God. Did he just get into the lake? Did he fall in there?
I hope he sashayed down the beach. I hope he went, and then he instantly got
right back up,
grabbed a ham croqueta, and on his way. Yeah.
Un master.
He yells thunder and gets yelled at by his wife.
Let's see what happened.
Coughing water, whatever. Everybody came, all the adults. You know what happened? Nothing. Drinking.
Yeah.
Eating. After everything was done, drinking and eating and partying like nothing ever happened.
I love it.
I'll never forget that day. I'll even call him. Talk about it.
Yeah, because it traumatized you, Izzy. That's why you won't forget it. That's childhood trauma.
Hold on. This sounds like a dad joke. He was messing with you and...
That's also traumatizing if your dad does that to you.
Yeah, but it was the 80s. It was a different time. You would traumatize your kids by making them think you were dead.
Try doing that to your boys and see what happens.
My wife does it.
Like, does she?
She'll just lay on the floor and then the boy and like,
what?
Wake up. And then she catch you. You thought I was dead. And then we'll laugh and laugh.
It's called the Izzy.
Everybody does that, right? I thought you trick your kids into thinking you're dead. And then you laugh and
laugh. You know what's funny is I'm kind of a prankster. And I have never done that to Maisie. I never have.
You know, you don't wake up and they're shaking you. And they're like, hey.
The sad thing, though, is when I do it, Maisie walks in, just goes right to her room. Just leaves me. Leaves me laying there. I'm not even going to try it because I know I'll be disappointed.
But I'll call the coroner.
So do you consider Izzy a hero? Did he save a life?
Is he a hero?
You think dad was faking it?
I feel like the dad was pranking him because if he was truly floating face down in a lake, I feel
Izzy said he was peeing in the water.
Oh, because I feel like if that was the case, an 8-year old.
Wait, so your dad was peeing in the water and passed out?
Yeah, sometimes you do that.
Like, because
that's pretty awesome.
Like my paramedic buddy says that even mouth to mouth on the CPR only works 10 or like 3% of the time or something like that.
Yeah, so, you kind of talked me out of doing it to people.
Well, no. He's still worth a shot.
After you gave me the truth of that and recycling, I stopped both immediately.
And I feel like, you know, pounding on someone's chest if they're truly drowned and
that's
and not
just what
breathing,
you do to let everybody else around you. It's like virtue signaling, right? You pound on the chest to let people know that you cared, but you didn't. You can't do anything.
Yeah. Because
like, come back.
That
to
doesn't
me.
Really
yeah.
do anything. No. So I. That's why it leads me to believe that he was fake. But
yeah, we'll
believe
find
what you want.
Yeah. That's true.
What's going on, dudes? So I'm listening to the Friday Freak Show with Ross talking about the Farts license plate, and a friend of mine has a next door neighbor that owns an electric vehicle, and that guy's license plate says DDLG. Yep.
I'm sorry, BBLG?
DDLG?
DDLG?
That way. I like how Rick is like, yep, like we're supposed to know. I told you some letters and now be shocked.
I saw a guy yesterday do a thing.
You know what that means.
DDLG.
It stands for Daddy Dom Little Girl.
Well, how the hell would we know that?
A sexual relationship where the dominant male is the daddy figure and the woman plays the role of a young girl. We're not into that stuff, yeah. Big Rick, so we didn't know.
Yeah. You have to let us know. We're not a sicko.
You also said he has an electric car. What did that have to do with it?
You're giving us
details. Sicko's got a Tesla.
Yeah. Daddy got that electric car.
When you give us details and then some mystery, we think the details have to do with the mystery.
Yeah, I was trying to solve it.
We're like, is something electric? Like, what?
This is the worst escape room ever.
Double D batteries? What's he talking about?
What are you doing?
All right, let's take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to talk to Skyler from Trulieve. Welcome back to a Corporate Time. So with our medical marijuana dispensary partner, we've got Skyler from Trulieve on the line. What's going on, Skyler?
Another day, another busy cannabis.
Yeah,
stuff going on.
You guys are like the most busy with all of the rollouts and... Sam and I were just talking about we opted in to get our text messages, and man, you guys got deals galore.
Yep, we do. We actually have a sale we're about to roll out here soon today. We have stuff going on throughout the whole week, and then we're gearing up for 420, which is four weeks away, a month away.
So 420, obviously the biggest holiday of the year for Trulieve, correct?
So I would say by far it's 420 and then also 710 in July, which is oil.
Yeah. I actually went more big. I went more crazy on 710. But 420.
You did?
Yeah, okay. I think I did. It is the heralded marijuana holiday.
Yeah, because I mean, so if you think about it, 420 usually people are thinking of like flower, which if you're more of an oil concentrate guy or gal or person, whoever, it's going to be that you're going to like 710. Do you like oil better than flour?
I do.
Yep. So there you go.
Yep. That is why.
For 420, you think of 420, you think of flour and a joint and, you know, smoking a bowl and those sort of things.
Norm is trying to help you out.
But it's still a very big holiday.
710 is oil backwards.
Oh.
It's what your wife does with 1134.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Correct.
I honestly thought it was a joke about you're too high to work the last hour of the 7-Eleven.
Like 7-10.
Wow.
That's pretty funny. I can only give you 7-10. That's funny.
I mean, you never know. Maybe it's
7-11,
that's how it is.
Yeah, 7-10, man. We're not around the clock.
So, Skyler, on 420, what can we expect as far as, like, things that we can enjoy from Trulieve?
Yeah, so we're going to have a whole different activation this year than we've had in the past. So it's going to be several days. We're going to be highlighting brand partners and stuff like that. But obviously, on 420, there's going to be a big celebration. The thing, you know, that we started to realize is that a lot of people are stocking up for 420 before 420, and then 420, they really want to celebrate. So make sure that you, you know, subscribe to our text messages, our emails, follow us on social, those sort of things. You can stay in the loop of what's going on, because there's going to be a lot of really, really cool deals and a lot of really cool swag, not just from us, but from all of our brand partners. So it's going to be a really cool couple weeks.
Yeah, the swag is what I get bothered. Well, I don't want to say bothered. I don't want to make it negative at all. But I get listeners asking all the time. And you know the number one thing you guys did, and I wrote it down on my paper to ask you today. This is the number one thing I get asked about, is that damn football jersey you guys gave away. And I get more email about, like, how can I get a Trulieve football jersey? And I'm like, dude, I didn't even get one. These were, apparently, it was just one day. Yeah. I know people that have them. I've seen people that have them. I think Travis has one.
Really?
They're awesome. But, like, are you guys doing something like that? Is that kind of like that vibe again?
Yeah. So it's going to be different. Obviously, it's going to be a really cool package. But the football jerseys, we launched during football season.
Oh, yeah, that was for Super Bowl or something.
So we just did it during football season. So I think we started it around August, September.
Oh, they love that.
And so when preseason started, But what we could do is, I actually think we may have, and I have to go back and check, so don't hold me to this, I think we may have a few football jerseys that maybe we could send to you guys to give out to a few lucky winners.
That would be rad.
420.
That would be rad, because our guys ask me about it all the time, because it's such a ridiculous, cool, it's a ridiculous and ridiculously cool piece of merch have, if you like collecting it for your, you know, whatever.
Well, speaking of that, I know that people loved those red BDM cloth keychains. We are giving those out currently right now.
Best keychain we've ever made, in my opinion.
With a Trulieve beanie and some Tom and Dan stickers. Yep. All you have to do is, when you visit a Trulieve and purchase something, you go on TomandDan.com. You'll see the little web ad that says Trulieve free gift. Click on it, fill it out, submit your picture of what you purchased, and then Eric will send you the BDM keychain, the Trulieve beanie, some stickers, some stuff, all for free. Just show us that you went to Trulieve. And we've been doing that for a couple of years now, and we always are getting new stuff. But right now, while they last, those BDM keychains will be sent out. So I know we sold out of them quick, and we kept a bunch for this promotion. So, Skylar, any other news from Trulieve we should know about? New store openings coming up, anything like that?
Oh, there's always new store openings. We don't have anything right now, but we are opening a new store in April, and then we will have a few more coming down the line. And a new store here actually very soon. So like I said, stay tuned. I mean, we always share stuff on social media, and one of the stores could be in your area. And there's always great activations on site, great discounts. We always promote heading on over and supporting our grand openings. But then today we are having 25% off a $100 purchase or more, and it's going to run until the 26th. So it's going to be 2 days. If you spend $100, you get 25% off.
That's dope.
Awesome. And Skylar, I'm sure you're privy to information about, like, people, or are you, like, do you, does Trulieve, or does anybody know how many people have their medical marijuana cards, or is that all protected by some sort of
that's a good question.
Like,
HIPAA? is there any?
No, so we do, and I know that it changes all the time, so I don't know the exact number right now. I haven't looked at it in about 2 weeks, but I know it's over 500,000 patients in the state of Florida. So if you go on the Department of Health, you can see how many patients there are. You just can't see, like, personal information, right? Like, we can't see that Joe Schmo has his card and he lives in Brandon, right?
Oh, I know Joe Schmo. I know Mr. Schmo. Mr. Schmo is high.
High Schmo.
He's having a great time. Yeah, but you can see the number of active cards in Florida right now.
Skylar, is it what people thought? Like,
that sounds that to me,
it sounds not as much as I thought.
When you say that, then it actually makes me feel like I'm kind of a cool dude, because I thought it was not millions. Very many people.
Like, just based on how many people are in Florida.
What are you guys, idiots? You didn't get your license. What are you doing?
Who's out there listening to this and like holding back for whatever reason?
Don't you want to have it just a half? My God, what's wrong with you?
You can go to Trulieve, buy whatever you want.
I mean, there should be more people, right? And I think it comes down to, I mean, you two are incredible because you share your story and you talk very openly about having your cannabis card and using products. And, you know, same with listeners and stuff. And that's how it should be. And that's how it should be. People should be more honest. But I also respect people's privacy as well.
Sure.
And so I think that, one, there's just, you know, that's why we go to a lot of events. We do a lot of stuff virtually. We do have a lot of partnerships like we do with you all, so we can let people know that there is a cannabis program in Florida, because you would be surprised how many conferences and different events I'll go to and talk to people. And there's at least one group of people that did not have any idea that there's a cannabis program in Florida, and it has been around for several years.
Crazy. Yeah. I actually had a friend of mine reach out to me about a friend of his that was like, hey, I got a really good friend. They want to increase their appetite. They can't. And I'm like, why don't you have your medical marijuana card? I feel fairly certain that in the very early occurrences of medical marijuana, one of the greatest things that it can do for people that aren't able to keep on weight or get an appetite is that it can instantly do that. You know, and it's it's been known. And I'm like, well, that's be an easy, all natural, easy breezy way for you to use something that isn't like some sort of strange pharmaceutical that you can get a.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and so I hooked them up, but.
It also, like, people, I think there's misconceptions about what, like, medical problem you need to have to be even qualify.
Yeah.
And, like, one of...
Or how to find a doctor.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, finding a doctor, I feel like now, like, there's a lot of advertisements on, you see on the side of, strip malls where it's, like, medical marijuana. I feel like people run across that.
You know the ones that I've seen that I'm surprised they're able to do this? It's with the hot girls in nurses' costume that have the green cross on their boobs?
Yeah.
Skylar, I see that. I'm like, how do they get away with that?
Trashier neighborhood.
By the way, my doctor does not look like that.
But, like, anxiety is a listed problem that can qualify you for a medical marijuana card. I'm like, I'm virtually certain every human being has felt anxiety before at one point of the you know what I'm saying? Like,
here's one that
maybe absolutely. I mean there's levels of it. Like Daniel suffers from severe anxiety.
Yeah, I do.
But if you suffer from any sort of anxiety, you
can
qualify.
What about Crohn's disease or IBS? Like
I have IBS. Have you felt pain?
Yep.
I've talked about this before. We make jokes about it. I have IBS, but my IBS is like under control. You know why? Because I found a strain that I know that if I have an attack, I have it at the house. I have a strain of marijuana that I can use that seemingly makes those symptoms go away and does not cause me stomach problems. It's pretty awesome.
So anyway, just it's easy to find. I mean, Document J and you just go to Trulieve.com and all the information's there. It'll walk you through it. So if you're on the fence or even like questioning what any of the stipulations are, Trulieve.com will tell you.
Yeah, all the information is there and it's always updated.
So Skylar, anything else you want to talk about or that's coming up?
So we have a ton of 420 events, so stay tuned to see, where we're going to be. Actually, one of them is in Orlando, and I would love to get y'all out there. It's huge. It's called Florida Grove Festival. It's on April 16th.
Nice.
And there's going to be thousands of people there. It's at the fairgrounds in Orlando. And we're going to have a bunch of brand partners out there, so you can get to talk to the people who are directly working with brands. Like Bobby Tuna and Binsk is going to be out there, one of our edible partners,
nice.
And they have a few other different products. But yes, there's going to be a ton of people like that out there, along with ourselves, obviously. And then we're also going to raffle off some VIP tickets as well. So for those of you listening, if you're interested, you can see what that looks like. Just stay tuned. 420 is going to be rocking and rolling. Also, I forgot I had something open on my phone, and there's actually almost 700,000 medical patients here in Florida, so 695,000 a week.
That's a lot.
Okay.
So it's a little off.
Yeah, it's moving.
It is. Yeah.
It's moving along.
I thought it was well
in
past
the millions.
But
it's not.
But,
it was past a million.
We'll fix that.
Yep.
I'm sure it'll get there eventually. I was just curious if that was like the estimated projections of where we'd be at, or if it's less than what the companies or the government thought. You know, I'm just...
Yeah, you want the real sensitive information.
Or just if it's like, whoa, more people than we thought. Like, I'm curious to what...
It sounds low to me.
Yeah,
it does.
Like, when they started this whole... Like, when it first became... you know, medical, someone had to have been like, all right, in 5 years we'll have X amount.
Skylar, you'll like this. I was in the Aloma Trulieve, and call them kids only because I feel like an old man, but my bud tender behind there, they were clowning me a little bit because I had to actually send in a check to the state to get my medical card. And they thought that was hilarious.
Oh, at the beginning?
Yeah, and it really hurt my, it kind of hurt my feelings. They did nothing wrong. They were the sweetest people ever.
Like,
I love
it. Took 7 months.
That location is my favorite. Shout out to the Aloma guys. They're the best. But man, did they clown me hard. They're like, you wrote a physical check with real gross, old man. Yeah.
Well, they even make those.
Exactly. They used an envelope.
Well, Skylar, thanks so much for telling us about everything that's going on at Trulieve, and we'll talk to you soon, okay?
Of course. Yes. You guys have a great rest of your week.
All right. You as well. Take care. That is Skylar, live from, I think she's always on a business trip.
Yeah.
Almost always.
Always on the move.
Driving to do something. And the fact
think about how fast that industry is growing. Like, you know,
the fact that she is always available for us is actually really, it's such a, like, a testament to them. Yeah, for being cool to us.
When do you think it turns recreational? It seems like the talk about that
feels
has,
like it already is.
Like, calm down. Like, I feel like most people that like demanded it got their medical card and they're like unmotivated.
Good enough for now.
Yeah. Because even me, I'm like kind of like, this works pretty well. Like,
there's also been a lot of other stuff going on in this state.
You wanted
recently,
to cut down
so
on
people
your...
aren't really focused on it because they can still get the weed if they want it.
You were trying to cut down on your booze, right?
Yeah.
You were craving a different kind of bug.
Should have.
You want to do another voicemail?
Yes.
Okay. Let me pull up a few here. I already had this one. We did the license plate guy, right? Yeah, we did. Big Rick talking about the license plate. Yeah, we did that.
Oh, yeah.
That was a great one. Glad you kept that one, Dan. Great job. let's try this one.
Hey, Tom and Dan. You guys pay Sam for a reason because she's a top-notch producer, so maybe you should listen to your producer about producing content, and when she says you guys are doing too many pre-taped shows, maybe listen to her, because I swear to God, on one of the BDM shows in the last like 3 or 4 weeks, you guys were talking about Michael Jackson dying and trying to sell Belvin Perry t-shirts. I mean, come on, guys.
Hilarious.
Okay, get out of here. Sir, we're pre-recording so we could play
new content
while we were gone, thinking that people wanted that.
They want no content over pre-recorded new content.
None of
so
our.
So you'd rather have nothing than.
He was being facetious, but I get what he's saying.
Nothing that we talk about.
We should have done Belvin Perry shirts, though. We should have done
I did Belvin Perry did shirts you? Back in the day, and it said, Belvin is my homeboy. And then in thinking that it was, like, racial in any way and disrespectful to him, in calling him a homeboy as a black guy, I didn't pull the trigger, and I said,
that's probably a smart move.
I'm going to step away from that. But I do have one, and it's sewn into a quilt.
Also, we do have, even though I like to yell that we don't, just pure radio listeners, terrestrial radio listeners that listen on the drive home, and that's the only way they listen to us.
Yeah, we have those people.
And those people we wanted new shows for because they wouldn't know. Like, it was a new show to them.
I'm sure Jack wants new shows. You know, he doesn't want us.
No, he appreciates every time we go on vacation, I'm like, hey, we pre-recorded the first hour. And then he's like, I appreciate you doing that. So it's new content instead of just best of.
I appreciate him.
Yeah, but I get it. The people that listen to us on Twitch or right when we release stuff or whatever, or really,
let's start recording individual BDM shows for each BDM every week. Every
well, no,
week.
You only get one. You only get one. It's going to take us until we decide to stop to get them all out.
You get one custom show.
Yeah.
For yourself.
Yeah.
We'll talk about it. We'll go on your Facebook. We'll look up.
We'll roast you.
Yeah, we'll roast you. Your family.
God, imagine how long that would take.
Oh, God.
When would we quit?
I think I do maybe six of them.
Well, what do we do? Are we doing a full hour?
You got to do two and a half hours. Friday free show. They get a Friday free show.
No, the extra long ones are like 2:50. Yeah. 2 hours, 50 minutes.
They want a 3 hour. I'll put songs in there too. What kind of music do you like?
Yeah, yeah. Custom to you.
Yeah.
$195
now,
a month.
Now, I will be willing. I will be willing to do it if somebody wanted that. Do you want a show about your entire family? Do you want a show about your Facebook? I'll put custom songs in there. Sure, we'll do it. But you have to pay us $2,000. And then we'll do the show. And then we'll split up that money between everybody.
I was at the airport. And it's Eagle Airport, right? And before we left, I got three grilled cheese sandwiches with fries, right?
God, you don't need that much carbs. That's
a lot of
for my wife and the kids. Oh. And then I got
a lot of grilled cheeses in that house.
A pre-made ham sandwich.
Oh, and you should have went grilled cheese.
Yeah, buddy.
And then we got some drinks and a chip or whatever.
Chip.
$71.
Yeah,
right?
Man.
And then I laughed about reading BDM complaint after BDM complaint about how we didn't, we gave them pre-recorded shows. And they
paid gave us trash.
$1.95 a month. $1.95. Oh, 1 month.
Does Stripe take some of that
cut? Yeah, we don't get
$70 for some grilled cheese.
A portion, yeah.
$1.70.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know how expensive everything is right now? Like it's crazy. Like, our rent just went up. Everything's crazy expensive. Mm, like,
insurance,
inflation.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Like,
taxes.
So much money. People's houses are worth $500,000. You live in
Castleberry. Rock and roll the walls. I can take it anymore. We didn't start the fire.
$1.95. 1 month?
It's crazy.
Anyway.
Half of the people in the BDM group aren't even paying. They're late. They're delinquent. And they're still
complaining. Those are the ones that complain.
The people that complain the most are no longer members. And I haven't figured out how to get them out of there.
It's too hard. We got to look up their name and there's a whole thing.
I'm barely in there now.
They're the only ones getting the BDM Appreciation Week prizes.
These people are so negative. I'm not even in there.
I got an Oculus.
Complain more. We'll send you the prizes.
This place sucks. So does this Oculus I got for free. It sucks too. $195, biatches.
2 years ago. my credit card. Wow.
Expired.
Let's just do one more. One more. Here we go.
Hey, BDM George here in Ain't City. I just heard, I thought it was hilarious, Tom talking about when they were out of town and ordered pizza and they get a Ring doorbell notification and it's the pizza. They didn't change the address. And then when they ordered again,
I like how he's recanting your story. That was my favorite part of. That's why I didn't even listen to the rest of this. And all I had to hear was him telling your story, and I'm like, I'm in.
I'm gonna call up and retell Tom's story, but not be excited at all.
Monotone as hell.
It's my favorite here.
And then when they ordered again, the raccoons, and then I heard Samantha's story about Boston Market and then showing up and the store just being closed after you're told it's ready. I had kind of a weird situation with ordering food. I ordered through the Subway app.
Subway?
Oh, man. It cut off right there. I don't know what happened. No, I'm kidding. It's there.
Died.
You ordered that through the Subway app.
I didn't even know they had an app.
I didn't know they had an app either.
Yeah, you would think they wouldn't be allowed to have an app because of Jared, right?
Right.
Like, not allowed.
Like, it's not fast enough when you just go there and they make it in front of you. Like, it seems pretty quick. Right, you're like, nope, not fast enough. I need it ready by the time I get
here's
there.
Here's what I would say. The people, I haven't been to Subway in an eternity. Yeah, but
you need to watch them, too.
The last time I got a Subway was with you, probably at this Subway that's no longer here.
Yeah, yeah.
We lost our Subway.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But I can only imagine, they're so disinterested while I'm in line, I can only imagine how more disinterested they are if they just see a text come in of what I want.
Yeah, yeah. Also, the only thing that keeps them from making a mistake is you watching them.
Yeah, you have to watch them.
Yeah, yeah. And then you can get to tell them, like, a couple more onions, please. You only put one sliver on a whole.
Onions are expensive.
Like, that doesn't look full long.
Can I have more of the sweet onion teriyaki sauce or whatever that garbage is? Here, he continues.
Yeah, I know, Subway.
He knew.
Two subs and... When I called the place...
Wait a minute, I got another gripe. I'm sorry, I got to stop you. If you're ordering delivery, you cannot... Okay, this is a problem that you do this, and you're wrong. Delivery is for two people plus. Delivery is not for one person.
It's not worth it,
white
man.
White trash people do.
They do. White trash people will order one tiny small kid's meal to the house, and that's it. Or one hamburger.
We're bad with money.
But you got to save it up. Like, the only time...
It's a bad combination of laziness and poor money and financial decisions.
Bad at life.
Maybe it has gotten me this way now, but if it's me and I'm staying at the house, she's away or something like that, and I'm getting takeout, I go get my takeout and come home. I don't order it to the house.
No. Oh, I will sit in my backyard and order one Jersey Mike's with a Diet Coke. Mm-hmm. It'll be... $25. I'm not coming to work. I'm too embarrassed to show my face.
Are they gone? Okay.
Yeah. Then I go get it. It's all Coke is
watered
down.
Do you get a Mike's way?
No, but I like...
you like mayonnaise.
I don't like the lettuce. I hate shredded lettuce on myself.
Really? I like it. Yeah. I like it. Mike's
it's
way.
It's a waste.
Mike, I don't think he puts mayonnaise when you get it Mike's way.
No, you have to add the mayonnaise.
Which is against Mike. Mike's like, what? How dare you go against Mike's way? My way is Mike's way, the highway.
Why don't you like mayonnaise, Mike?
It seems because like I used to call him that. Aww. I used to call him Mayonnaise Mike.
It seems like most
I'm going to start my own sandwich shop, and I'm going to have it my way. It's called Mike's Way. When you get it, there'll be no goddamn mayonnaise.
Have it your way, BK. Everyone knows that.
Oh, this guy continues. Okay.
So I ordered it through the Subway app. Oh, no, they called me and basically told me they don't deliver. They don't do this. Like, they don't. I said,
they don't do what? Make stuff?
He's my favorite caller. He's so sweet. This guy calls a lot. He's so good. He's
like, they're not involved. How do they even get opted into the app? Like, if it's Uber Eats, don't the store have...
No, he said it was Subway app, not Uber Eats.
Yeah, Subway app. He'll continue.
Or maybe I called them. Something. Either way, I spoke to the person, and then
I feel like this guy is younger Puerto Rican Tom. Right?
Yeah. You obviously have made those horrible
mistakes. This guy is you.
Mistake.
This guy is you. And listen, he didn't even know if he called or they called.
Or maybe I called them. Either way, I spoke to the person, and then I wanted to speak to the manager. That person was a manager, apparently, or the person in charge there at the time. And they said they don't do orders. They don't do orders where people, they make...
We all make sandwiches. Well,
I don't understand. They don't make orders.
Like, you can't call in a pre-order. Like, you have to made to order.
You gotta be standing there watching them.
That's not true. I used to take orders over the goddamn phone at Subway. It's terrible.
Maybe they tell that. They say that because they're tired of people ordering stuff and never coming.
It's like
to
when you walk in here and, like, it's like, we're closed.
It's like the Facebook, is this still available? Then you ghost them forever.
Right.
Like, why did you press that? Anyway, bye-bye.